you wear your hat, the way you sip your tea, the memory of all that. No, no, they can't take that away from me, the way your smile just beams, the way you sing off key, the way you haunt my dreams. Take that away from me. We may never, never meet again on that bumpy road to love. Still, I'll always, always keep the memory of the way you hold your knife, the way we dance till three, the way you changed my life. No, 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 they can't take that away from me. No, they can't take that away from me.
Seem to know that you didn't mean all those sighs. The night that you told me those little white lies, I try, but there's no forgetting. When evening appears, I sigh, but there's no regretting. In spite of my tears, the devil was in your heart, but heaven was in your eyes. The night that you told me those little white lies.
Okay, we're going to get the Santa Barbara City Council meeting started. I'm sorry that we were a little late. The ordinance committee went over. They were doing the good work. So, yeah, no, they just went over. They wouldn't stop talking.
I think it has something to do with the two-minute time frame not quite working.
Well, you have to start earlier, they said, next time, and that's okay. Yeah. You can do that. That's good. Okay, so we're going to start the Santa Barbara City Council meeting and on March 3rd already, March 3rd, 2009. Will you please stand to say the Pledge of Allegiance with us? Thank you.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Will you please call the roll?
Councilmember Falcone?
Here.
Francisco?
Here.
Horton?
Here.
House? Schneider?
Here.
Williams?
Here.
Mayor Bloom?
Here.
Item number one, proclamation declaring March 7, 2009 as Arbor Day.
Okay. Are you up here? This is good. Thank you so much for coming. We really like Arbor Day here, but it's good to have the kids here, too. It's very wonderful. Arbor Day observances will be held in California during the week of March 7, 2009. The city of Santa Barbara has been designated Tree City USA for 29 years by the National Arbor Day Foundation. The city of Santa Barbara is proud of its approximately 50,000 public open space park and street trees and recognizes the importance of professional tree care and annual tree planting programs that create a more livable community. Arbor Day observances, I'm having trouble today with that, will be held at 7 local grade school campuses. This spring, Santa Barbara is celebrating 107 years of city parks, providing stewardship of trees, parks, and open spaces. The city acknowledges Santa Barbara Beautiful, a significant contribution to our urban forest through planting of over 11,000 street trees in the past 43 years. Therefore, we proclaim March 7, 2009 as Arbor Day in the city of Santa Barbara, and we recognize the value that trees provide in enhancing the quality of our lives. So here you are, and I will let you introduce the children.
Thank you.
You can see.
Honorable Mayor Bloom, Santa Barbara's beautiful council liaison, Das Williams, and council members and citizens of Santa Barbara, thank you for taking time for Santa Barbara Beautiful to share one of the most uplifting parts of our work to create and maintain our beautiful city, the Arbor Day Poster Contest. Since the year 2000, Santa Barbara Beautiful has served as the local sponsor for the Arbor Day National Poster Contest that's open to all fifth graders in the United States. This program combines environmental awareness with the creative process to build citizenship and a sense of community. From a pilot project that began in 2000 to this year with 6 local schools representing 3 school districts, hundreds of students have participated, competing to win, to create posters that encourage students to come into relationship with their environment. It has become Santa Barbara Beautiful's tradition to thank participants by planting a tree at their school. Many of you have participated in the tree plantings, talking to students, and lifting a shovel. Again this year, each participating school will receive a tree in the spring. Local winners move on to the state and then the national competition in Nebraska, which finishes in April. But today, our local poster contest winners, their families, their school principals, and their poster contest coordinators are with us, and we want to introduce them to you. If you would stand as I say your name. From Adams School, Mildred Gonzalez, winner. Marjorie Variano, Principal, Deidre Barrett, School Contest Coordinator. Cleveland School, Leslie Negrete, winner, Mike Vail, Principal, Jill Sawicki, Art Teacher. Cold Spring School, Lauren Suh, winner, Dr. Brian McCabe, Superintendent, Sasha Pickles, School Contest Coordinator. Franklin School, Alejandra Diaz, winner, Casey Kilgore, Principal, Stephanie Bagish, School Contest Coordinator. Marymount School, Chloe Hausch, winner, Deborah David, Head of School, Elizabeth Hansen, Lower School Division Head, Sarah McGuire, Art Teacher. Roosevelt School, Maddie Rotman, winner, Dr. Donna Ronzone, Principal, and Skip Smith, Art Teacher. We also have a very brief PowerPoint presentation that showcases the local winners and their artistic creations. We'll hope you enjoy them as much as we do. Let's the show begin.
Well, that was wonderful. Thank you. Could we just have each of the children come up here? And I know there were some cameras that people wanted to take some pictures. And so each of the children, and I know it's funny when we introduced the principals didn't want to stand up. I know it's like, you know, maybe the adults are too shy, but the kids are just great. So, and where are the boys? Usually, we do usually have some boys, but this is good. This is girl power today, so this is very good. So you need to look right up there, and we're going to give you a clap. See, the TV camera up there is going to get you all for posterity, and we'll give them a clap. Thank you very much. Thank you for coming. This is wonderful. Thank you for your beautiful artwork, too. And I want to thank our little moderator over there, too. He was great, wasn't he? See you later. Okay, thank you very much. Yeah, I think so, too. There you go. Thank you.
Item number 2, employee recognition service award pins.
Okay. Is Pauline? There she is. She's getting out. I can see. I was going to say, I saw her earlier, but so many kids here. It's just wonderful. I don't know if you've ever been to an Arbor Day celebration at school. The kids all wear, you know, tree hats, and it's just absolutely wonderful. It's really wonderful. No, at any of these schools, I think there are 5 or 6 schools that are going to do it this year, they plant a tree. And it's usually I think Adams School is this Friday, I think it is. But, you know, just wonderful. Very, very good. So we're very happy to honor you today, Pauline. Let me give you your pin. 30 years is a long time, so, yeah. Pauline Reyes started her career with the City of Santa Barbara in November 1978 as a temporary secretary in the Public Works Department. The temporary didn't last very long, did it? No. She was hired full-time as a secretary in March 97, and eventually she was promoted to principal accounting clerk with the Public Works Motor Pool Division. Pauline helped the city usher in the computer age, beginning with the implementation of the city's first work order management software, and later the city's accounting program. In 1994, Pauline was promoted to her current position of accounting assistant in the Public Works Building Maintenance Division. Pauline has received numerous awards over the years. She was recognized as Public Works Employee of the Month for exemplary performance in building maintenance. She's also received the department's Swift Award multiple times for her hard work. Pauline is an accomplished marathoner. She competes in 2 to 3 marathons a year. And she competes annually in marathons in Los Angeles, Honolulu, and has even participated in events in Paris, France, and London, England. Pauline and her husband, Abel, have been married 23 years and reside in Carpinteria. Pauline has one son, Ted, who is an independent journalist and a filmmaker. Pauline, you've been a dedicated and a valuable member of the City of Santa Barbara staff, and it's an honor to recognize you for your 30 years of service, as well as your many personal and professional accomplishments. On behalf of the City Council and your fellow citizens, thank you so much, and congratulations on this outstanding achievement.
You're welcome. Oh, goodness.
Always surprising when I do that.
I love to get up with a mic. Actually, the 30 years has gone extremely fast. And most of that time has been, well, I've enjoyed my life along with working for the city. So 30 years, it's a long time, but it goes by so quickly. So enjoy every moment.
Thanks,
thank you.
Pauline. Thank you so much. Mr. Armstrong?
Yes, Madam Mayor. In addition to Pauline today, we're recognizing an additional 18 other employees who will receive service pins in their department. And altogether, they represent 215 years of service to the city. And I wanted to read their names into the record. First, with 5 years, Sarah Connect, who's an assistant city attorney. Allison DeBusk, project planner and community development. Brady Beck, who's a firefighter. Eric Fairbank, firefighter. Bill Kavanaugh, firefighter. George Martinez, fire engineer. Brian Ritchie, who's a firefighter. Looks like we hired a lot of firefighters 5 years ago. Dennis Diaz, senior network and application analyst in the police department. And Chris Payne, who's a police officer. With 10 years, Marianne Knight, who's our computer training coordinator and administrative services. Jeff Lancaster, senior building inspector and community development. Adam Zeitz, who's an engineering tech in public works. And Frank Cruz, who's a senior streets maintenance worker in public works. And with 20 years, Martha Shute, who's an accounting assistant down in finance. Susie Reardon, who's a senior planner in community development. Gina Sansari, who's a fire inspector. Scott Naganuma, who's a police officer. Eric Ingebretson, who's a harbor patrol officer.
Thank you very much. Congratulations to all of them. We are now on to changes in the agenda.
There are no changes, Madam
okay,
Mayor.
We have some people that would like to have public comment. Jack Wilson to be followed by Liz Anderson. Thank you for coming, everybody.
Okay. Thank you, Mayor Bloom and City Council members and viewing public. I come to share with you the loss, the death of Chris and Jeremy this last week. They were members of our community for years. They do have an eternal home with God, but they were homeless here in Santa Barbara. I got to have a description of them from Ken Williams, who has been a social worker in Santa Barbara for, I believe, about 30 years and probably knows the homeless better than anyone else. And he wrote, Chris Hulga will always be remembered for her kind yet sad smile and dedication and love that Max, her German shepherd, had for her. Christ was a kind woman ending up on the streets, the victim of violence. Max was her protective, and all of us at the shelter adopted her as our own. Jeremy Goddard was a kind man with a sad smile, always ready with greeting and helpful to all. At 42, he died way too young. The streets have a way of aging one beyond their years. Now, in honor and respect for Chris and Jeremy, I just ask for a moment of silence and prayer. Thank you. I have also, sadly, gotten two more emails from Ken today.
You know, you've used your 2 minutes. Is there something your wife could do?
Yeah, just read this. It'll just take a moment.
Very sad.
But, coming out from behind a dumpster in her home. Let me read the second one, which is even worse. With sadness and disbelief, I have confirmed that two of our homeless friends have been found dead. I will keep their names and circumstances out of this message till the police have had a chance to notify next of kin. Incredibly, this brings to 11 members the number of deaths on the Santa Barbara street since January the 1st. We need to offer our thoughts and prayers to the homeless and redouble our efforts to bring this national disgrace to an end. In Christ's name, amen.
Thank you. Liz Anderson will be followed by Lazarus. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I was very encouraged to hear that you met with the President, Mayor, Honorable Mayor, and I'm very encouraged. I want to hear more about that. Honorable Mayor and City Council members, thank you once again for the opportunity to pray for you today. Father, I pray for your supernatural protection over each council member today. As each item is brought forth on the agenda, I pray that you soften each member's heart to hear what the person's concern may be at any given moment. I pray that as each person expresses their issues or concerns, that you would give them a great sense of peace and hope that only comes from you. I pray that your presence is sensed here today and that your presence would encourage those who need to be encouraged, give hope to those who need hope, and peace to those who need peace. Father, I pray that the meeting goes well today and that you continue to build up the team that the City Council members represent. Give each member what they need spiritually, mentally, emotionally, and physically to meet the needs of the community today and together as a team throughout the days ahead. I pray for resolutions today and continued efforts in providing answers to real problems in the community. I pray for strength and hope for all the residents of Santa Barbara that are facing serious difficulties in their homes, finances, jobs, and family. Please help us to encourage and help each other rather than judge or walk away from those who need our assistance. Heal those who are wounded spiritually, mentally, emotionally, and physically. I pray that those who can help and have the resources to help others in need will step up and offer their support in a spirit of willingness and love. Father, most of all, remove the anger in each one of us and replace it with love. The love you have for each one of us is more powerful than we can possibly comprehend. Remove the obstacles in our life so and to freely love and give to one another as you provide for us individually. Help us to appreciate what we have and thank you daily for everything we do have. Increase our faith in you to do what appears to us is impossible. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Liz. Lazarus will be followed by Wayne Scholes.
Madam Mayor, ladies and gentlemen of the City Council, I'm Lazarus. You know, I was talking at the county meeting, you know, and I was talking about how much money, you know, the community itself loses when people don't get the federal assistance they need. And I was a little bit off. I said $1 million per 1,000 per year. That's actually $1 million per 1,000 per month. So that's like $12 million. And, you know, I think that, you know, I mean, you want to talk about Hillary Clinton. I read something in one of her books about stimulating the local economy. You know, when you leave the poor out of that cycle, they become a liability and to the whole community. I mean, not just to the people sitting here. I think it's pretty evident that that's what's happened. And this city and the county has lost billions of dollars because mostly because of this tough love thing, which is born of a few people's envy and fear, where they're afraid that if somebody got money, my gosh, they might spend it on the wrong thing or something. Gee, you know what? I think we know there's people out there who get money spending on the wrong things, but, you know, they're going to do it. They do it. You know, the people, you know, they're always going to come up with a way. And I think that, you know, the city has more control and financial interest in going after that money that is owed to these people and seeking the damages that the city has suffered from that money not coming into this community than to go after people's right to free speech and their constitutional right to consume alcohol. You know, I think that, you know, you have more control over that and more financial interests. In other words, you know, to do this would actually, you know, create an asset rather than a liability and cost tons of money. You're actually talking about making money instead of spending it. Yeah, I mean, there's ways to control that money when you get
seconds.
It coming in. You just need to look into those ways. The thing is, that's federal money that these people, including myself, are entitled to, that we're not getting.
Thank you.
And I just want to say that, 11 people since January, you know what, they're going to find my body out there one day, and you're all going to say, well, that's probably a good thing, because you all hate me. And that's evident, so... Have a nice day. Thank you.
Wayne Scholes will be followed by David Daniel Diaz.
Hi. Today I'm going to read from an article that was in the Santa Barbara News Press Saturday, February 28th, and it involves myself. The city of Santa Barbara just spent tens of thousands of dollars to prosecute a frivolous criminal complaint initiated by Police Chief Camarino Sanchez against Wayne Scholes, a Mesa resident for more than 25 years. On Wednesday, after less than 3 hours of deliberation, 12 jurors unanimously acquitted Mr. Scholes of both charges, challenging the fight and disturbing the peace with volume. They did so after 6 days of hearings in Superior Court. The case grew out of an incident in Shoreline Park last June 27, 2008, when Mr. Scholes and Chief Sanchez got into argument after Mr. Scholes approached the chief to discuss a lack of law enforcement in the park where Mr. Scholes is advocate for the elderly. Chief Sanchez testified that Mr. Scholes shouted at him, "Someone needs to kick your blank, I'm going to do it, you M blank F blanking Mexican." However, jurors in Judge Gene Dandona's courtroom did not find Chief Sanchez's testimony credible. For not only was the chief's testimony consistently inconsistent with regard to detail, but his awkward delivery and body language, including facial twitches and contortions, suggested untruthfulness to observers. Far more important, all four witnesses to the Scholes-Sanchez altercation testified that Mr. Scholes never threatened Chief Sanchez with physical violence, never challenged him to fight, and never uttered a racist epithet. When Chief Sanchez was asked on the stand what Mr. Scholes had been charged with, he replied, "I don't know. I haven't seen the police report." Yet according to testimony of Officer Rines, who arrived on the scene minutes after the police chief called for backup, Chief Sanchez was the arresting officer. Such circumstances beg this question. How can an officer arrest someone without knowing what he's charged?
10 seconds.
It can only mean that Chief Sanchez arrested Mr. Scholes simply to have him removed by force from a public park where the chief's nephew's wedding was underway. Thus, Mr. Scholes was handcuffed and bustled by police cruiser to the police station, where his interrogator, Detective Hunter, tried to coerce him into admitting that he challenged Chief Sanchez to fight, stating that
Mr. Scholes
had the police already.
Thank you.
Thank you for your 2 minutes, Mayor, and I appreciate you halting public comment from 3 minutes to 2 minutes.
No, it's really 1 minute on the front of the agenda, if you look at it. Thank you very much. David Daniel Diaz, followed by
Kate Smith. This is online if anybody would like to read this in entirety, and I have copies if anybody would like a copy. This is a very serious situation.
Congratulations.
You're welcome.
Good afternoon, Council, Mayor, Santa Barbara. Passing out is a little flyer. There's been some graffiti activity being conducted up at the Winchester Gun Club, and I know lots of law enforcement locally resource that area to keep up in tune with their firing capabilities. On the second page, it shows the graffiti next to the Indian artwork. And we had a meeting a few weeks ago with the Forest Service on trying to decide what to do and how to do, because the lease renewal was coming up. And this was one of the suggestions I gave. It was the Tahigas Gun Club would be transferred over to the Winchester Gun Club would be transferred over to the Tahigas landfill in the backside that's been closed for quite a while. And it would only be open perhaps 6 days a week when the dump is open. And it would be safer, easier, and more easier to control and monitor the pollution. And the reduction of fire capabilities would just drop immensely, because if there were a fire there from bullets flying around, it would just cross the freeway to the ocean and the fire would be dead. But up in this area, there's some problems with the winds blowing in all different directions. So I just thought I would share this with you as a result of the meeting a few weeks ago with the Forest Service, and hopefully we can work in finding a new location, because our law enforcement, they do need a viable close area to practice. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Kate Smith will be followed by the last speaker, Mr. McCollum.
Madam Mayor, members of the Santa Barbara City Council, my name is Kate Smith. God bless America. When the power of love overcomes the love of power and the love of the money and the prestige that comes along with it, then there will be peace in the world. You've just heard Wayne Scholes read from an article from the Santa Barbara News Press about his court trial. He's thrown down the gauntlet. I had the same lawyer, Robert Landier, and I've worked with Robert Erringer, who's paid by Wendy McCaw, a billionaire, so that he doesn't have to worry about being sued for libel. Nobody will do that. He's speaking the truth. My court case was 10 years ago. I was arrested falsely 4 times by the Santa Barbara School District, and I will come before you to tell you the terms of those arrests. My lawyer, Robert Landier, recused or tried to recuse D.A. Tom Snedden, who had helped Bill Cerrone craft the truancy and parent accountability program. That program has spread throughout the United States. It's now called the School to Prison Pipeline. That program was the beginning of what is now understood online as school corruption. It is rampant, systematic, and systemic. And the retaliation against the whistleblowers is severe. For his recusal, he wrote a letter to the Attorney General. The next day, he wrote a letter with 12 items wherein he recanted his words, but he didn't send it to the Attorney General. It took a year and a half before D.A. Glogau dropped the charges. I had 8 lawyers. Maureen Graves' bill was $800,000.
Could you wind up, please? 2 minutes is up.
And I spent $1.5 million. I am a victim of retaliation, abuse of power, and I will submit to you the 6 documents that are online at SB School Talk that you need to read about school corruption.
Thank you, Mr. McCollum. You can take these to your handouts.
Honorable Madam Mayor, City Council members, my name is Richard McCollum, spokesman for the SOS Advocacy Group. I was born and raised in Santa Barbara and hold in high regard my ability to voice opinion in public forum. We at SOS represent those in the city who cannot appear today due to physical and or mental limitations, because I believe, as you do, that the people deserve a voice. Having worked not only for this group, but with the developmentally disabled for 2.5 years, it has come to my attention that the city is responsible for numerous violations of federal and state laws as they pertain to the Americans with Disabilities Act of 1990. We wish to be helpful by pointing out these violations, with the goal that the violations might be remedied for the benefit of the most vulnerable of our people. We ask your cooperation to deal with these issues efficiently and inexpensively, avoiding any cost of litigation. At this time, I would like to call to your attention the urgent need for revisions to many public facilities, including broken, deformed, and blocked sidewalks, access to the harbor and its slips, elevators at the Paseo Nuevo Mall, especially one leading to the Social Security offices. Our city hall itself is not in compliance. These are the most urgent concerns, but we have found other safety issues in our city concerning lighting at night on the east side, railings for our piers, and a many number of the disabled parking spaces are poorly located and inadequate for those with wheelchairs. I know the budget is slim these days.
10 seconds.
Mayor, City Council members, I ask you to put yourself in their shoes, to know what it's like to be disabled and to be blocked from where you need to go, to be unable to speak in public forum, as I am blessed to do today. Thank you for your time and consideration.
Mr. Williams?
Just for their information, I just thought I'd mention the fact that we do have an access advisory committee. It's made up of folks with experience in these matters that help staff prioritize projects for compliance with the Americans with Disabilities Act. So you should look them up. And they met last week. They'll probably have another meeting at some point soon. And you should bring some of your concerns to them, because that would be the right way to accomplish that.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. We also have an access plan, too, that they're implementing. Thank you. Okay. Finance Committee, Mr. Horton.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. The Finance Committee met for 2 hours today. We discussed the mid-year review, which is coming up later on the agenda. And we began a discussion of the Infrastructure Financing Task Force report, which is very important to the city and to the capital planning for the future. And I think will take us probably a number of more meetings to conclude and come back to you on that report.
Okay, thank you. We're going to go to the consent calendar, which I didn't mean to forget. I just was moving us on too fast. Consent calendar, does anybody have anything to take off? And I don't think there's anything to read today. Okay, can I have a motion, please?
Move to
second.
Okay, all those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Okay, report from the Ordinance Committee. Mr. Williams. Thank you.
Today, the Ordinance Committee met at 12:30 in Council Chambers, and we were discussing the Alternative Building Heights Charter Amendment, or the and the idea of a supplemental instead of an alternative. The committee was split on the idea. We are recommending an Alternative Building Heights Charter Amendment to Council, but we do feel like there are parts of the implementing ordinance that need detail, and so we are going to have one more Ordinance Committee meeting about that before it comes to Council, so that you have something substantive to look at when we're at Council.
And is that next week? I wasn't sure.
I believe so,
okay.
Though I know staff sometimes need an additional week, but the goal is, I believe, to bring it all to Council by the 24th.
Of March. Okay, good. Yes, did you have something?
And we're starting a meeting at noon, you may like to know.
Oh, that's good. No, it's always, there's always, well, it always fills the time, whatever you have, so that's true. But thank you for starting a little earlier. Makes it hard when we're behind the ball here. Item number six, please.
Item number six, fiscal year 2009 mid-year review.
Okay, Mr. Samario.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, members of Council. My name is... And as Councilmember Horton indicated, we just got through a pretty lengthy meeting with the Finance Committee. One of the topics we covered was this report, the mid-year report. We went into pretty good detail, so I don't intend to go into it too much detail today. I'm just going to provide a summarized version of that. Really, the purpose today is to cover two things. We just, as we normally do at mid-year, we give you a report on where we're at with revenues and expenditures in relation to budget. So we'll be covering that for both the general fund and enterprise funds. But it's also to present to you an updated strategy for balancing the current year, fiscal year 2009 budget. As you know, we've talked to you in the past about our projected deficits of about $5.5 million a few months ago. Well, that number's changed now, and so we needed to implement additional measures to close the larger gap, which is now closer to $6.7 million. So we'll be talking about that, as well as the adjustments needed to rebalance the budget this year. So what I'd like to do is first start with a look at revenues. These are general fund revenues, and we're going to focus on what we call non-departmental revenues. Those are not the fees and charges from departments, but those that are mostly tax revenues and other non-departmental revenues. And this first slide is looking at the major tax revenues, starting, of course, with sales taxes. And you can see the first column of numbers is the currently adopted budget, the annual budget. And to the right of that is our current, most recent revised estimate of where we're going to be by the end of the year, this year, and what that really means that by way of an estimated growth for the year, and what the variance is then at, that we're projecting at year end. And as you can see, without getting into too many of the details, you can see that sales taxes this year, we're expecting them to fall short of budget by over $1.5 million. That one tax alone has been obviously hit hard by the economic environment. The unfortunate part about this is that we really don't have a lot of data related to sales tax. In about 3 weeks, March 20th, thereabouts, we're going to receive the information from the State Board of Equalization on what the fourth quarter, which is ending, the quarter ended December 31st, what that quarter did. We have no idea what it's going to do. We're projecting sort of a flat or even a little slightly decline in the revenues for the remainder of the year, but that could be anywhere from 0 to 7%. The statewide projections are actually in the neighborhood of 7% decline, so we're going to be paying attention to that one closely. Property tax revenues, you could see that we're actually projecting a growth of 3.2%, so it's actually not too bad. We're still going to expect a shortfall this year of about $140,000, which is not too bad considering what sales tax and TOT are doing. TOT, this is, again, based on information through December 31st. We get our payments from the hotels on a month lag, so this is based on November month through November and receipts collected through December. And you can see that at this point we're projecting about $500,000 shortfall. I'll tell you that the next couple months, just since December, 1 month was down over 11%, almost 12%. That was December that we got paid in January, and then January was down about 1.6%, so a pretty dramatic swing in 2 months. Fortunately, the December month is one of the smaller dollar months, so the impact isn't as great, but we're hopeful that it's not going to be indicative of what the rest of the year will bring. Utility users tax is doing okay. The sectors are pretty strong. The of note is the natural gas sector. That's actually up 25%. Unfortunately, only represents about 10% of the total revenues, but it's still good news. But in total, you can see that just in these four key revenues, we're expecting a shortfall of almost $2.1 million. Maybe you can switch it to, you already did. Wow, excellent. So these are some of the other non-departmental revenues that we think are important to look at. Interest income, as you know, interest rates are falling dramatically. We still have securities that are paying at a much higher yield than the market is currently bringing. So we are still projecting to be at budget by the end of the year. But next year, for sure, we have are going to be lowering our recommended estimate for interest. Since as we get securities maturing, we're going to be replacing them, obviously, with lower yielding securities. Franchise tax revenues, franchise fees are almost bang on the dot in terms of where we're expecting to be at the end of the year. And they really follow tandem with utility users tax, so still remain fairly strong at 3.8% growth for the year that we're projecting. Property tax, transfer tax, let's just say, it's a budget of $500,000. We're expecting to be short $166,000. That's about a third, 26% actually a decline. It's just tied to the housing market, not a lot of sales happening, and so the volume. This is based on transactions of sales, so as the transactions decline, so do the revenues. And then VLF, as one of the questions was asked in the committee meeting, we suspect that the decline is due to just the reduction in sales and automobiles, but we really don't know how the state comes up with these payments. They're all over the map during the year, and we never really know why they're up or down at any given time. But still, you can see that the variance in total for just these four is over $300,000. Rudy, if you can focus that a little bit, or not focus, but there you go. Thank you. So moving on to general fund expenditures, and this is a normal presentation. We show the annual budget, the first column of numbers, and then the next column, which says year-to-date budget. Essentially what we do is we take that annual budget and divide it by two. Since it's halfway through the year, we say, okay, what's half of that budget mid-year and compare it to actual expenditures, and that provides us somewhat of a meaningful comparison. Not real clean, not always nice and neat, but somewhat of a starting point to compare how we're doing against actual expenditures throughout the year. As you can see that we have some departments that are well over their budget at mid-year, and notably the fire department and the police department, and there are obviously good reasons why those are over. Police department, as you know, a lot of their costs for overtime are incurred in the first part of the year with the various festivals, whether it be 4th of July or Fiesta. But they also had an unusually high number of retirements, as you know, in this first half of the year. We had a deputy police chief and a couple captains that retired, in addition to some others. So that's a large part of why they're over. Fire department, as you know, they've been responded over the last year, 18 months really, to a number of fire incidents, and they do receive reimbursement, mutual aid reimbursements, and it's not just to reimburse overtime costs, but also covers some administrative or overhead, if you will, and sometimes they actually make a profit. So these costs are offset, fortunately, by actually more than that in revenue, and we'll look at that as one of your adjustments later. Parks and Recreation, same thing, it's seasonal. They have a lot of recreation programs, classes that occur in the summer, so you're going to expect to see typically those costs being ahead of budget at mid-year, but we expect them to normalize. Let's take a look at, let me just back up, I'm sorry, just one last comment. you'll see that while this shows that we are in an unfavorable status of about $3.2 million at mid-year, we do in fact expect to be not only meet the budget but be well under budget, and we'll be talking about that more. But one of the strategies we're employing this year is to have departments bring in savings and expenditure size primarily of about $3 million, and that number now has kind of grown to 3.5 just based on further deterioration of our revenues. And we do expect, based on what's been submitted by the various departments and their plans for how they're going to address it this year, that they will be able to achieve the $3 or $3.5 million in savings by year end. Okay. Thank you, Rudy. Enterprise funds, I'm not going to spend a lot of time with these. You know, the expenses, a lot of timing differences is in there. I could tell you that at this point, we don't see anything that would suggest that all of these funds won't meet their appropriations by year end, that they will be under budget on the expenditure side or expense side. But I would like to talk a little bit about the revenues on some of these funds. Water fund, you can see at the very top, you can see that in the fourth column of numbers to the right, that they are well over budget this year in terms of revenues, $1.2 million. And this is obviously tied to the weather conditions. We've had a dry, hot 6 months, first half of the year, so water sales are up. We've had a couple months where it's been fairly wet. Even with that, though, they're expecting that by the end of the year, they'd be close, or at least between $500,000 and $1 million over budget by year end. On the expense side, I will comment on just the water fund only. They are well over budget on expenses on the expense side, and we'll be talking about that because a lot of that has to do with the extraordinary costs they're incurring for treating the water at Cater because of the results of the Sac-A fire. The wastewater fund revenues are above budget. Same thing. It's tied to the water in a sense. Not really affected by the economic conditions. It's a utility, so it's pretty stable. Downtown parking, you can see a shortfall of about $96,000. They actually expect to be about $200,000 to $300,000 short by year end. It's just the number of transactions, parking transactions, and the structures and the lots are well below their projections. I think they projected about $5 million, and now they revised that to about $4.2 or $3 million this year. Airport, as you know, the employments are down, which means terminal revenues, whether it be concessions or parking or rental cars, those are down. And in fact, usually their commercial or industrial revenues, the lease revenues are pretty stable, but because of the economic environment, they're having a hard time filling some vacancies. And the golf fund, I can attest to the fact that play is down. I play every week, and it's a lot faster and a lot easier to play in these days, but their rounds are down 5 to 6% so far this year. And so the revenues are reflecting that reduction in play. They are going to be able to offset that with reductions in expenses this year. And then lastly, the waterfront fund, really with the exception of slip transfer fees, all their revenues are holding pretty strong. It's really an anomaly, in my opinion, because you look at the rest of the city where we see our sales taxes go down. Their lease revenues, which are tied to, of course, the restaurants and businesses there, are holding strong. In fact, I heard from Scott Reedman, the business manager, that for this past calendar year, some of their businesses had their record sales, which is amazing. Parking is holding steady. But it's really the slip transfer fees, which are generated when people sell their boats and really are they're exchanging slips. It's just not occurring just because, just like housing, the housing market sort of dried up because of lack of credit, tight market, same reason for why sales are down for boats. So they're expecting to, at this point, to be about $400,000 short of budget by year end, and they'll make that up with cost savings. So in terms of the recommended adjustments, we've broken them out between those that are really stemming from departmental requests and those that we're going to need to rebalance the budget. So we'll start with those requested by departments. And you can see that there are really just two in the general fund. The first is from the fire department. And this is to recognize and provide funding for the additional cost, overtime costs have incurred in responding to mutual aid calls. They are proposing a request to increase appropriations by $755,000. They're also requesting to increase revenues by $1 million, and these are revenues. This is money in the bank that they've received. So we're increasing the revenues to fund those additional costs and then some. And they've also, and I'll explain why this, the combination of numbers, is sort of looks unusual. How it all makes sense, but they've also are preparing or recommending to reduce their vehicle replacement costs. They're going to defer replacement of some vehicles, which will save them $131,000. The sum of those three adjustments is about $380,000. That's their share of the $3 million adjustment or savings that we allocated to all departments. So their share is not going to come in from expenditure savings, but rather it will be from additional revenues beyond their costs. So that, again, that's the net positive, if you will. And that'll be their contribution. It'll be through revenues rather than expenditure savings. We've also are recommending an increase in appropriations in the police department to cover the extraordinarily high payouts for vacation and accumulated leave with the retirement of staff. So in total, you can see that the impact to the general fund's fund balance is about $18,000. Most of that is covered, of the additional appropriations of $1 million is covered from additional revenues. The next three relate to really one request. It's in the Information Systems Fund. They are proposing to replace the existing servers with new technology. It's supposed to be pretty swift and slick. I talked to Rob. It's pretty complicated, so I won't get into it. But essentially, the way they're funding that $168,000 project is a combination of three sources. The first one you'll see, City Hall Allocation Fund. There's some reserves there that they're going to contribute to that project, so we're recommending to transfer some of those reserves over to their capital fund. They're also wanting to use about $55,000 in their reserves from their operating fund toward that project. And you see all those monies moving into the third of that, the Information Systems Capital Fund. And then the balance is going to be coming from a reallocation of monies that for a GIS project that they're working on, some savings they incurred of $80,000. So again, those three sources are going to fund a $168,000 project to upgrade the infrastructure with new technology. And then the next one is the Waste Water Fund. I alluded to this earlier. They are incurring extraordinary costs for treating the water because of the Zac fire and the runoff into the water system. In total, I think they'll probably be incurring somewhere close to $1.5 million this year just for treating the water beyond what they normally would. So this $500,000 is to provide appropriation authority to cover those costs. In the wastewater fund, the next two are related. As you know, we have a sewer lateral program that's been really successful, and they budgeted $500,000 to do so. But maybe as if we're victims of our own success, the program has done so well that there is a greater demand than we expected, and they need more money this year to respond to that demand, and that amount is going to be $350,000. It's coming from essentially what they call their sewer overflow compliance program, but that's really their sewer main program. It's an annual program, and they're taking about $350,000 from about $2.1 million they have for that program to fund the sewer lateral program enhancement. I understand that they will be coming to council in April or May to be talking about what to do long term, because their rates aren't a sufficient support an additional $350,000 or another $500,000 per year. It's really to cover $500,000. So the question is, do we expand the program or limit it to $500,000? But that'll be coming back to council sometime in April or May. Okay. And then just kind of lastly, I wanted just to give you this updated schedule, which shows what our projected deficit is and what our strategy is to address the deficit. The numbers in the top half are what we just talked about, all the revenues, the shortfalls we're expecting. The one thing we didn't talk about in this presentation, but we have in the past, is the fact that departmental revenues are expecting to be short of budget as well, particularly community development fees. They actually represent that $1.07 million that they're expecting to be short this year because just the fact that development activity has come to a halt. In the police department, parking violations, for a reason we've talked about before, just because we have an online system where they can pay on time, and the fact that the fines double, it's really caused people to pay more quickly and avoid those late fees. So our revised or projected deficit for this year is not 5.5, but $6.7 million. And the strategy is really the same. We just kind of bumped up some of the numbers. The expenditure savings, instead of $3 million, are now $3.5 million. The one-time measures this year includes appropriated reserves. We actually budgeted that this year in anticipation of additional economic problems. It turned out to be not quite enough, obviously, but it is going to help, $700,000 towards that problem. We're also going to be transferring $1 million from our workers' comp fund reserves. They have a total of about $2 million that we consider to be excess above what the actuaries tell us we need based on outstanding claims. And so we're taking half of that, which is really the general fund's portion, and bring it into the general fund to help balance the budget. The ICS funds, which is building maintenance, motor pool, facilities maintenance, et cetera, we've asked them to give us a rebate this year of 3%, which represents $243,000. And then we've also we are also taking street sweeping fund reserves, or at least recommended to do so. Those street sweeping fund reserves were generated through over time through a surplus in the revenues generated from the parking violations for people who are parking when they're not supposed to, and the cost to ramp up that program. And there's about $1 million in that fund, and we're taking half of that this year. And then lastly, we are proposing to reduce several capital programs, one of which is the FMS project. I think we've talked about that before, that we would be delaying that. That's about more than half of that total. And while we think our FMS is kind of on its last legs, we do believe it can last us several more years. So we're not in jeopardy, for example, of having our FMS kind of collapse. So we're deferring that project for about a year. And the remainder of those capital programs are related to parks, and it's just deferring essentially a year some of these projects. And I won't get into the detail. This is basically all the budget entries, believe it or not, that are required in order for us to just implement what I just talked about, all those measures. It's the reduction of the sales of all our tax revenues, the bringing in of money from other funds, et cetera. And that's what all this represents. So I won't go into any detail unless you really want me to. But this is what's required, and I'd be happy at this point to answer any questions you might have.
Okay, are there any questions? Mr. Horton, do you have something?
I just wanted to clarify for council that we had quite a lengthy discussion on this matter at the meeting, and really to say that what's being proposed here by staff is a way to get us to where they think we need to be at the end of the year. And that does not necessarily mean, or in any way mean, that these are the actions that they would take for future and upcoming budgets. They have spent many hours putting this together to try to take care of the current problem that we're trying to solve as a city, so that we can get there and maintain the level of services that we want to the extent that we can. But in the budget process that we're about to enter, that will be the place where we will talk about the specific inputs and discussion about impacts on departments and what services that we think may have to be reduced, include some staffing decisions that are very critical and things like that. So I just wanted to clarify that point for council that we did talk about it, and we raised several questions about the reductions here, but this isn't the ongoing matter that comes up as we enter the process that we're about to start. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Schneider, and then Mr.
Thank Williams. You, yeah. Rudy. Could you put up the general fund slide that shows the encumbrances column? Thank you. I appreciate what Mr. wanted to emphasize the detailed discussion we had at Finance Committee. But I also want to just bring up for the general public or for the council that this slide here, just to show how normally accounting procedures work when we look at budgets, but if you look at the bottom line that shows a $3.23 million deficit, you might make an automatic assumption that how in the world did we start with a balanced budget on July 1st and automatically get to such a big deficit. But I want to put my attention to the encumbrance column of $1.8 million. Much of those funds are things that happen in the first quarter of the year that we pay every year. For example, $250,000 in police overtime for Fiesta, or the funds to the arts programs that go out in July, or the human services funding that happened that starts paying out in July. So those encumbrances, by the end of the year, most of them will balance itself out. And so I just want to bring that up. Another example is the summertime parks and recreation programs that only happen in the summer. So just to say that's what you would normally see in a regular budget procedure, but I want to emphasize that doesn't mean that we're going to be $7 million in the hole by the end of the year. Most of that encumbrances money is going to, you know, balance itself out as we move from January 1st to the end of the fiscal year in June. And I think it's important just to put that out there to explain that, because I don't want to see inadvertent headlines showing that we're, you know, way off base from the beginning of our budget, when in fact this is just a general accounting procedure that most agencies use. So thank you for that.
Madam Mayor, I wanted to just clarify one small detail on Councilmember Schneider, and that is money that's gone out the door, for example, expenses by the police department on overtime for Fiesta, or, for example, the fire cost that, for mutual aid, are actually in the year-to-date actual. And so you already have the seasonal variation there and the dollars out the door. And then in the encumbrances, what you have is contracts that we have already issued for services or for supplies that we have not yet paid the money out. And a couple of those that are large, the one in community development, are all of the human service contracts that we have issued to various nonprofit organizations that will then be paid out. So you actually get a combination of the seasonal variation that occurs in the expenses as well as these contracts. For example, in our office, we have a contract with a labor law firm that it's a contract and we have to book it. In reality, we're probably not even going to spend most of that money, but because we book the amount of the not-to-exceed amount, it tends to make those expenses look higher. So I just wanted to clarify, there's actually two parts of the seasonality here.
Okay. I appreciate that clarification from finance. And the other clarification I want to make on the other slide that showed the reserves being used, for example, the appropriated reserves of $700,000, that's very different than what people normally think of when they think of our reserves. The reserves that were used in this, say the workers' comp reserves, the appropriated reserves, the street sweeping fund reserves, these are different and separate from the 10% or the 15% general fund reserve balance that we have in our policy. The appropriated reserves we put into the budget, the $700,000, because we thought the state might, for example, in their state budget concerns, might take some money. And so we actually put money in the budget for that contingency. So just to be clear that we're not using, in terms of balance this particular budget, the 10% general fund reserve or the 15% disaster reserves that we have in our policy. There's not 1 cent in there. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Williams?
So I just want to make it clear for us and clear for the public that if we approve the mid-year adjustments in Attachment 3, how much will we spend down our general fund reserves?
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Williams, based on these adjustments, the impact to the general fund, as I indicated, I think in one of those slides, Rudy, was about $18,000.
So essentially, we would be close to balancing
yes.
our budget
yes.
through these mid-year adjustments.
Right. That is correct.
That's what I like to hear.
And if I could add to that, I just, responding to Councilmember Snyder's comments, one of our goals this year is, in fact, to avoid using any reserves. So these measures we're talking about, whether it be appropriated reserves or reserves some other funds, it's specifically to avoid having to use the 10% or the 15% reserves in the general fund. That is our goal.
Right.
And I just want to clarify, we think we've been pretty pessimistic about revenues for the rest of the year, but predicting the economy in a big period of time for us will be in about 2 weeks when we get our March sales tax in to see if we have been pessimistic enough. So we think we've been there, but this economy is so difficult to predict, it makes it hard.
It's amazing.
Well, I agree with being preparing for the worst, maybe not. And then the attachment 4 is looking into the future of what we are going to have to continue to do for the following year. So essentially what still needs to be worked out is where that 3.5 million expenditure savings is coming from. That's what we're
Madam Mayor,
not yet seeing the detail of.
Councilmember Williams, actually, the adjustments that I showed after this slide were the adjustments to implement these measures. And if our revenues hold steady and everything goes out as we hope they will, we will end of the year not using any reserves. And this is the strategy for this current year, not for next year. We're going to have a whole conversation about fiscal 2010 in the next several months. But this is this year. And hopefully this will cover us for this year so we don't use reserves by year end.
So essentially all the adjustments on attachment 3 add up to that 3.5 million.
Okay. Essentially, yes.
And then we're still looking at having to make about 8.5 to 9% adjustments for the following year, or does these or do a percentage of these adjustments account for part of that percentage?
Councilmember Williams, the answer to that is these are in most cases are sort of one-time measures this year. You know, when you look at a six-month problem, it's a whole different approach than when you're looking at a more long-term sustainable solution. So these are things, as Bob Pearson has said in the committee meeting, that we just kind of cobbled together to make sure we don't use reserves this year. But what we're bringing in the next several months is a much more comprehensive and long-term solution to the deficit.
But just to clarify, in that $3.5 million of savings that the departments are generating this year, I wouldn't be surprised if much of those savings are from positions being held vacant because departments are proposing them to be vacant next year. And so, I mean, clearly, if a department knows that they're going to have to make adjustments next year and a position becomes vacant, then they're already restructuring, you know, and if somebody leaves, they're not filling the position. So part of that is, you know, already they're preparing themselves for next year.
Great. Thank you.
Okay.
And I guess I'll just throw in one thing. I do believe that this is great. I really appreciate the Finance Committee's work on this and appreciate staff's work on this. But I do believe that we should be continuing to prepare for the worst. I don't think we're out of the woods yet, and I don't think anybody thinks we are. But I particularly think we need to look at some basic things that we're going to have to continue to do, including, I believe, hold open our fire chief position for some time. I really appreciate the fact that two of our municipal unions have put forth their own suggestions for budget cuts, and I hope that staff's found some of those useful, because I've never seen that done before, and I think that's a good idea for us to all be working together on what things we can do without, so that we can be responsible to the public about their finances.
Okay, thank you. Mr. House?
Just going down my list of questions I had, most of them were just answered. To be sure I understand, our sales tax, I'm going to lose my voice today. Well, sales taxes, we don't know for sure. We won't know for another couple weeks or so, right? And that's the biggest one of the whole group, besides the TOT. And with regards to the reserves, I've had people question, and I think you've answered it for us, but I just want to make sure it's so explicit. We have disaster reserves, I guess we'll call them, that we've managed to squirrel away over some long period of time. And I want you just to say, to what degree does this at all touch that?
Madam Mayor, Councilmember House, this plan does not require or involve the use of any reserves, whether it be budgetary reserves or the disaster reserves, the 10 and the 15% respectively. So again, we still have some exposure with revenues, but if things hold like, you know, we hope they would, this would not involve the use of additional reserves, whether it be disaster or budgetary.
I know it seems redundant to have had you say that again, but it's just... Next year, of course, we're going to be looking at how we continue to maintain that practice, and even perhaps in more difficult times, we're not sure how it's going to go. I think that's probably the biggest part. And then with regards to the revenue side of how we as a city take initiative in any way, shape, or form to affect the revenue side of the equation. Again, this is coming as a business guy, just sort of, you know, I don't just look at my costs. If all I did was look at my costs, I wouldn't be around very long. So to what degree do we as a city participate, not just in looking back at how things turned out, but as we look forward, I guess we're going to be doing our whole budget thing for next year. But how do we approach this from a generative side? What do we do? That has to do with our fees and those kinds of things, right?
Madam Mayor, Councilmember House, that's a tough question. You're right. We can look at our fees and try to find ways to raise our fees to recover more of our costs. But sometimes that can work against you because you raise fees too much, then people start participating in programs or don't use the services.
Right. We did that with our Parks and Recreation departments for out-of-the-area residents, for instance, I guess, and we got the...
Yeah, and, you know, the large revenues, like sales tax revenues, I'm not sure what we can do. It's just it's a creature of the economic environment. We're in a tough time right now, and we're really... I guess, what's the word, beholden to what the economy does. And if when good times, we know the revenues go up without us doing anything, and in bad times, they go down without us doing anything. And it's a difficult one to sort of to address.
Well, and then the last thing is I wanted to comment, and I'm glad that Mr. Williams mentioned it. It appears that we have, as we look forward, not just to what you're giving us today, we're getting active participation by the people who actually do the work that are actually in the hot seat, if you will, of trying to live within these budgets. And I just think that's remarkable and deserves to be commended. And I hope we can get that spirit of cooperation as we move forward. Because without it, I don't know. It seems like it would be very difficult top down to be able to accomplish what we need to do. Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Horton.
If there's no further discussion, I'd like to move recommendations A, B, and C.
Okay, there's a motion and a second. I just wanted to say, in looking at all these cuts and so on, I don't see anything, how will I say this? I hope it's not taken wrong, but I don't see anything that people are going to really notice. I mean, the putting off of Kids World refurbishing, you know, kids need that, but it's in good shape now, so we're going to be okay. And that kind of thing is what we're doing. And but it does make it harder further out if we have to keep doing this over and over with various things. So, you know, I don't think anybody's going to say, oh, my gosh, we aren't doing anything, because all these are just cutbacks. They're kind of squeezing different programs. But I'm very glad that we could come up with this instead of using the reserves. I think it's very important.
I think your comments are right on the nose, and that's what we're going to be spending many hours on in the next few weeks.
That's true. Thank you. I want to thank the Finance Committee, too. You're doing a really good job. Okay, we have a motion, a second. Any other comment? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Thank you very much.
Oh, and Madam Mayor, just one thing
to
say.
Sure, go ahead. Sure.
And Mr. Samario, perhaps just we're going to just a moment. We have two items ahead of we'll be talking about our capital improvement projects, second quarter report for fiscal year 2009. That's coming up. Would you just say again out loud, I say again, for me, for us, that there's a distinction between our capital program and the operating budget that we just were discussing, because I truly believe it's hard for people to see us working over $6 million, $6.7 million, and then we're going to be talking about $22 million worth of capital program.
Sure.
Just a word to the distinction
between
those two things.
Madam Mayor, Councilmember House, you know, citywide, we have a pretty extensive capital program, but by and large, those programs or projects come from what we call our enterprise funds. They're not part of our general fund. The general fund does do some capital work, but it's really like playground equipment replacement and those kind of things. But it's closer to $1 million to $1.5 million. The vast majority of dollars come from water, wastewater, airport, downtown parking. Those are capital intensive operations. You can imagine maintaining a water system or a wastewater system. A lot of dollars are required just to maintain those systems, let alone just to enhance them or improve them. So, yeah, we still are continuing with our capital program, but it's really a small piece is the general fund portion.
Okay, Mr. Hart.
I wanted to follow up on that with Mr. House. The second part of the Finance Committee meeting today dealt with the Infrastructure Task Force report, and that really that whole subject deals with the capital needs of the city. And that committee spent a lot of time giving us an outline of a way to accomplish capital planning, in some cases different than we have been doing. One significant thing would be replacement cost versus purchase cost. Now, that makes a big, big difference if you think about a capital asset that was purchased maybe 20 years ago. So that kind of topic is one that we're going to be getting into in great detail in the next few weeks.
Okay. Thank you very much. Any other discussion? Okay. Thank you very much. We already voted. Item number 7.
Item number 7, proposed new business sector trash and recycling rate structure effective July 1, 2009.
Okay. Mr. Samario, are you doing this one too?
Thank you, Madam Mayor, members of council. Bob Samario, Assistant Finance Director, and I'm just being joined by Stephen McIntosh, the Environmental Services Supervisor, and really pleased today to bring to you a new set of rates, solid waste rates for our business sector. And I want to make sure everybody's clear that what we're talking about is the business sector now. We're not talking about the residential sectors, or so whether it be the single-family residential or multi-unit. This is just the business sector, and you might recall that over the last year and a half, when we brought to you sort of what our strategies were, what our plans were, that we showed you where we see the least amount of diversion across the city, and it happens to be in the business sector. Citywide, as you know, we are about 65-66%, but in the business sector, the diversion rate or recycling rate is only about 20%, so we see that as really our priority to try to go after them and try to get them to and encourage them to recycle more and get a lot of the volume that's in the waste stream out, in because it's going to Tahiguas, which has a limited life. And the fact is about 85% of what's in the business sector waste stream today is recyclable, 85%. And so it's, you know, when we see businesses that are 0 or 5% diversion rate or recycling rate, you know, we know that there's a great opportunity there. And so the purpose of this is really to provide that greater incentive and for people to recycle. I want to acknowledge first the fact that we have our two haulers here from Marburg, that's Derek Carlson, and from Allied Republic, Tor Schmidt. And as you probably know by now, this project has been underway for about a year now, which is really scary to say, but it's been about a year-long project, and they've been, from the very beginning, part of this project, and it's probably one of the most complicated projects that I've been involved with, not just because of the duration, but because of the nature of it, trying to come up with rates that really make sense, and it's a mathematical model that's very complicated, and we have hired a consultant to help us, but it's still very complicated. So our outline today is to provide you with just some background or review, if you will, what our goals were going into this, our approach and process to this project, what the objectives of the rate study are and were, and what policy recommendations we're bringing forward to you. And then we'll get into the details, the nuts and bolts of the actual rate study results, and we'll look at specific categories of customers, but also some examples of real customers, what the impact of these changes are going to be to their bills. We're also wanting to want to show you what the bills are going to look like. They're going to be different, which is good. And then we also want to talk about the impacts of these rate changes on our franchise agreements, and that's an important conversation. And then lastly, we'll talk about our, of course, the important part of this is the education and outreach effort that's going to that we're planning over the next several months before these rates become effective July 1. So unless there are any questions, I can dive into this. So the overarching goals, again, as I mentioned at the beginning, is to encourage a large shift towards increasing diversion in the business sector. You may or may not know that our current rate structure already provides pretty substantial incentives for businesses to recycle. They could save substantial amounts of money, but for whatever reason, it's just not been enough. And so that's one of our goals, is to try to provide greater incentives to the businesses to recycle. And as you know, we are also implementing a new program. We have a pilot program underway for fruit scraps recovery and composting, but we want to implement that program, you know, 100% starting July 1. So one of the goals, of course, is to establish new rates for that program. And then lastly, as I indicated before, is the customer bills, and this is not so much the case with the business sector, but primarily residential sector, the bills are really kind of confusing. It's hard for people to look at them and say, oh, am I being charged the right amount? What level of services am I really receiving? And it's complicated. And one of the goals I know from Councilmember Barnwell several years ago was always to let's make the bills easier to read so that people can self-audit and we don't have confusion and they can say, you know what, I can say, and also to know that they can save money if they can see what the pricing is.
Madam Mayor.
Okay. Ms. Falcone.
Yeah, as chair of that committee, I think it's really important that we get really clear here. The prior slide, it kind of mixes the two commercial programs with a comment about a residential program. And I think I just want to make it crystal clear that today, with the rate study and the rate changes that are being proposed, this is only in the commercial sector. This has nothing to do with rates changing for residential customers. So please, let's get really clear about that, because we don't want to have anybody suddenly confused. Thank you, Madam Mayor. I appreciate the time.
Okay. Mr. Samario.
Thank you. So our approach, as I indicated at the beginning, was we thought it was really, really important to include the two haulers in this project team. And I got to be honest, not only did we like want to have their buy-in, but their expertise in this area was invaluable, and they really helped us to get to the final product. We also hired a consultant. We didn't think we had the expertise in-house to be able to really develop a model that was as complex as the one we have, and particularly somebody who has that kind of experience. And using a rate model, it sounds kind of obvious, but we talked to a lot of consultants, and I think we, of all the ones we talked to, the one we selected is the only one that actually has developed a model in the past. Most people just sort of make more guesses, if you will. So we began this project back in April of 2008. We did a lot of research in looking at what other jurisdictions were doing with similar rate studies and didn't find a lot of what we're doing. Most of the rate studies in the past were with new contracts being executed rather than sort of midstream. So that's what added to a lot of the challenge of our project. So we began building the rate model with Weather Consultant. It was a very fluid process because we were kind of constantly changing and adjusting as we went along. But we did identify what the key policies were and develop some recommendations that we'll talk about. But we did come up to a consensus on a number of assumptions that were built into the model. And then, of course, we did present the results to the Solid Waste Committee over two meetings over the last couple months. And so the objective of the rate study is to further reward, penalize individual customers based on their current level of diversion. Again, the rates currently provide penalties, if you will, or rewards or incentives for diversion. We just want to create more of that, enhance that, if you will. But we also thought one of the key objectives was to allow all customers to be able to reduce their bill through increased diversion to even offset what they're paying today. So if they see an increase starting July 1, that they can lower their bill ultimately through increasing their diversion below what they're paying today, and in many cases to a substantial degree. And then we also wanted to address some of the illogical or anomalies that we had in the current rates, which really prevented people from moving from dumpsters down to carts and cans, and to save money, it really prevented that transition. And then lastly, which we'll talk about more later, is the concept of revenue neutrality, doing all this to making sure that the haulers, in the end, are kept financially whole. So the key policy recommendations that are included in the proposed rates today that we're presenting to you are really four. The first is that we established the sort of the threshold, if you will, at 50%, so that anybody who was below 50% diversion today would see their rates go up, whereas those who are above 50% today would see potentially a decline in their rates. So that would be the immediate impact. Again, they can all reduce their costs by increasing diversion, but that was one of our policy recommendations, that it be established at 50%. We considered 66%, which is really our overall target, but we thought that would be a little bit oppressive for the business sector, given that they're at 20% today. But we thought 50% was a good target for that sort of demarcation point. And then another recommendation is that we would discontinue free services with trash dumpsters only. And today, our current rates allow for 96 gallons of free recycling services to all customers, both cart and can customers who are the smaller businesses, if you will, as well as larger customers who are in dumpsters. And there were two reasons. First, it helped us in establishing a more uniform and proper rate structure, but also because in the dumpsters, the free containers are such a small portion of their overall waste stream. If you think about somebody who has 24 cubic yards of waste, 96 gallons is not even, it's just about a half a yard. It's really inconsequential to them. We undid that, but we provided other ways for them to save money through incentives in the rates to divert more. We did feel it was important to keep with the carts and cans because it is a significant portion of their waste stream. I mean, to have 96 gallons of free service or recycling services is significant to them because of their size. We also are recommending that we establish a frequency penalty, and this is really addressing some concerns on the part of the haulers that somebody who has three days of collection a week versus 6 days of collection a week for the same amount of volume, obviously a lot more expensive to the haulers to go out there six times a week rather than three. Why not get a larger container and reduce the frequency? And so for those who are, for whatever reason, aren't motivated to have fewer frequency collections, we want to establish a penalty for that to compensate, in a sense, for the additional cost. And then lastly, and this is something we talked about a great deal, particularly in the last couple of weeks, is how much cheaper should we make the diversion containers or the recycling containers, the green waste, the food scraps, and the recyclables, commingled recyclables. We were trying to land somewhere around 20%, to have a pretty good material differential between what they're paying for trash versus what they're paying for the diversion containers. In the end, we landed on 15% rather than a 20 because it really made the numbers work out better. We were generating, in a sense, too much revenues beyond what we wanted or needed by pricing it at 20%. At 15%, it helped us achieve all the rest of the goals and achieve the right level of revenues. Any questions with any of those? I think these are important policy issues.
Mr. Horton, did you have something?
No, it's more of a comment later on.
Okay, thanks. Okay. Go ahead.
So rate study results. This, I think, is really interesting because you'll see how this really drove how we approach setting new rates and who was going to be impacted the most and who was not. The first column you'll see is the number of cart and can customers. In total, it's about 590 or almost 600. But the number that are below 50% diversion today is about 211. But 387 are actually above 50% diversion today. And what's interesting is that the overall carts and cans customers represent only 6% of our waste stream. Now, when you move over to the larger customers, those are in dumpsters, you can see that a substantial number are below 50%, 1,034. That's almost a flip from the cart and can customers, and only 298 are above the 50%. And they represent, of course, the balance, 94% of the waste stream. So if you think about where would you throw your dart and try to, you know, focus your attention, it's obviously on this group here. The big customers, a lot of volume, a lot of waste, having a significant impact on our cost of the program, and they're diverting the least. So in terms of the results of the study itself, what we're able to come up with is in virtually all cases, customers will have an opportunity to save money on their trash bill by increasing diversion levels. So wherever they're at on the spectrum today of diversion levels, they would be able to achieve additional savings by increasing that. Now, I think if a customer is a 75% diversion today, which is, I don't know that we have any, but if they were theoretically at that level, I'm not sure they can save any more money because there's not much further you can go. But certainly if you're at 40, 50%, you will be able to save more money by getting to higher levels of diversion. And I said at the outset, on average, about 85% of everything in the waste stream is recyclable, and that's important to always kind of keep in mind. We also, and we'll talk more about this, but we also wanted to and intended to and were able to achieve the goal of generating additional funds for revenue stability and about 4.5%. And I'm going to go back to this because this is an important point. And then finally, you know, all this is driven, if you will, by what we assume is going to be the diversion increase over the next year. It's a circular sort of thing, but what is our targeted diversion for the next year based on what these rates are going to do to people's behavior? And we landed on basically a 14% increase in diversion by the end of next fiscal year, so June 30, 2010. But since it's starting from zero, in a sense, to where we're at today, to a 14% number, really it's an average of 7% for the year, right? If you're starting from July 1 and you achieve 14 at the end of the year, assuming it's fairly linear, you're going to have achieved an average of 7% additional diversion. And that was our goal. You know, we played a lot with a number, and a lot of that was driven by what we think we can accomplish and realistically accomplish in the food scrap program. We think there's more certainty there because we know what our plan is. Where, with respect to the other stuff, it's more about what are these rates going to really do to people's behavior, and that's a guess. So with carts and canned customers, again, they represent 31% of all business customers, yet only 6% of the commercial trash volume. And the results are that most customers in carts and cans, regardless of their diversion levels today, will see a very slight increase to their monthly bill if they take no action, almost a nominal increase to their bill. And again, we'll get into the actual specific examples of this. Customers with dumpsters, again, represent 69% of all commercial customers and 94% of the commercial waste volume. And most customers in dumpsters will see a relatively large increase in their monthly bill if they are below 50% diversion and if they take no action. Remember that one chart where I circled the big number, the 1,034. The reason we're proposing that we increase that group and their rate substantially is for that exact reason. So let's look at some specific categories of customers, and these are customer classes, and this is what we would consider a pretty large customer, 24 cubic yard customer. That means on average it's 8 yards picked up 3 times a week, 24 cubic yards. two dumpsters, if you will, each at 4 yards. You can see that for somebody today, and the first column, you see what they're assuming what their current diversion level would be. This is the spectrum. Somebody who is at 0% diversion today, meaning they have no, they're not recycling at all. And there are some customers out there that are really don't even have recycling containers. Their current bill is $1,382 today. Their new bill, July 1, if they took no action, would go up 27.4%, or about $400. It's a big hit. It's a big hit. But as part of it is that's the point. You know, that we want to see substantial movement in this group, particularly for somebody at this volume of trash and at 0% diversion. And you go down the scale, you can see that in this, and I'm going to use this pointer because this is the thing that's going to be helpful. This customer here who's currently paying $1,382 would be at $1,760, but if they just went down to 33% diversion, not even the 66 or 50%, but if they were able to achieve 33% diversion, which they can realistically do over a couple, three-week period just with some assistance from us, they can actually reduce their bill below what they're paying today. And that's the key. They're going to be hit hard initially if they don't do anything, but they can immediately take action to reduce their bill even below that. If they get to 50%, we're looking at a $350 swing, $360 savings. And if they were able to achieve 66, which is a really high target, of course, their bill will be cut almost in half. And that's the key. So we're seeing immediate impacts for this group. And you'll see it's different as we get to smaller containers or groups. But for these large customers, and there aren't that many. I mean, I guess think there may be in the order of 60 or 70 of these customers in this group. If I'm not mistaken, Stephen, I'm sure will correct me. But they represent such a large part of the volume. We want to make sure that they recognize the benefits, if you will, of increasing diversion. Any questions on this table? Okay. So here is a real customer, Cafe X. Obviously, hid the name to protect the innocent. They're currently diverting 3% of the waste, and their current bill is $1,208, almost $1,209. Their new bill, July 1, would be $1,345, so it'd be up about $1,345. I'm not sure what I said, but about $130 increase their bill. If they were just to get to 50% diversion, they would see a $200 or $175 or whatever that is, $125 savings to their current bill. So they can save money. Now, if they got to 66% diversion, they could get down to $800 per month, which is a $400 savings, and that's pretty material. The 12 cubic yard customers, still the larger, you know, larger customers, if you will, you can see that it's kind of a diminishing approach where, again, they're going to be hit hard, 18% increase immediately for somebody who's at zero. But they would have an opportunity to cut their bill substantially, essentially in half if they got to 66, save a couple hundred dollars just at 50% diversion. Somebody who's currently at 50% diversion today, they would see actually a decline in their rate starting July 1. And obviously, somebody at 66%, they'd actually see a material decline, 26%. So again, rewarding those who are high levels of diversion, penalizing those who aren't, but allowing everybody to get down to here and save money ultimately. So another customer, real customer, you can see the current bills. They're at 33% diversion, $641 is their bill. Their new bill would only go up to $656. But if they got to 50% diversion, it would be $528. And if the 66%, $383. And you can, again, it's the same concept as we move through. These are 8 cubic yard customers. They're the smallest, if you will, of this category of dumpsters. Their bill would go up not as much, still penalizing somebody at zero, but again, all cases able to save money by diverting more. And I just wanted to point out one concept. This current rate structure here, you can see, provides the incentives to save and to divert more, right? All we've done is expanded that range. We made this higher and this lower. So just expanding existing current incentives and rewards, or and penalties, if you will, that are already structurally in part of our current rate structure. Same thing. To somebody at 0%, they, by going to 50%, they can save $200, almost $200 in their bill. And substantially more than that if they're at 75. These are the, I guess I misspoke, these are probably the smallest these are the cart, we're moving into sort of dumpsters, carton can customers. You can see that somebody, and I have to say that this is a transitional customer, people that are kind of either at a small dumpster, able to go to a carton can. You're going to see something that really looks inconsistent with what our goals are, which is somebody who's at zero, they're going to see a savings in their bill. And this is just one of the fallouts of trying to cure what was an anomaly. And whenever you compare something that was sort of kind of illogical to a new logical rate structure, you're going to see illogical changes or results. There are a few customers with in this category, and we think, you know, all in all, the overall rate structure makes a lot of sense, and this is just one small group that's going to see some, maybe some, we have some unintended consequences or some rates that maybe we don't really care for as much, but overall, it shouldn't have a major impact, and we'll be working with these customers to still increase the diversion levels. Because mm-hmm. if you think about it, they can still go from zero, paying $150 to $124.88 by diverting more.
Mr. House has a question for you.
So I think that point is wouldn't be lost on this group either, would it? And when you do these charts, if you're looking not just to the right, but looking down, right. then you can actually calculate, and you're going to be working with them to calculate their savings if they were to right. step up and recycle more.
Right. Our focus won't be, well, look how much you can save by doing nothing. We'll say, look how much more you can save by increasing diversion levels.
Right. Very good. Thank you.
Again, I don't want to need to go through this to spend much time. Just somebody at 7%, what they can save if they got to 50 and 66% diversion levels. These are purely card and can customers, and this is pretty uniform. You'll see that they just all go up about 0.5%. I mean, essentially, they're flat. And again, they only represent 6% of the overall waste stream. They also have the opportunity to save money. We didn't see any need in trying to impact them to a great degree. A lot of our customers are already diverting at a high level. So just in order to keep the overall rate structure sort of sound, this is how we ended up with these customer classes. Okay, so last thing that I'm going to cover, then I'll turn it over to Stephen, is just the changes to the customer bills. This is an actual example of the same CAFE Acts, what their current bill looks like. It shows some descriptions of services. It includes some rental charges and, of course, the utility user's tax, but not a lot of detail, if you will, compared to what it's going to look like starting July 1. They'll see specifically how many, what volume of containers they have. The rental rate, it goes away because we blended it into the overall rate structure. They'll see how many containers they have, how many pickups they have, which will factor in their price. But they can just see, you know, how much they're paying for this versus this, and easily just ascertain how much money they can save by just shifting from these containers to these containers. So just providing a more simplified bill, easier to understand, for people to just know what they're getting in their services and what they're paying for. I lied. I have one more thing to cover. Excuse me. Okay, so impacts on franchise agreements. You may or may not know that our current contract provides that we are to keep revenues to our haulers essentially normalized. We adjust them every year by two things. One, the actual increase in disposal costs, so how much they're paying at Tahigua's, and that usually goes up $4 or $5 per year. And we just build that into the rates, add it to the rates, so it's really a pass-through. Then we also increase their operating costs or their revenues by 65% of CPI to compensate for increases in their operating costs. This year, CPI, I think, is almost zero or below 1%, so it's not going to be much of an increase, but it does provide some adjustments for the cost of living increases that they experience. The contract, unfortunately, says that we can do everything we want with respect to education, outreach, all those things, where people are going to be diverting more. And what that will do, of course, is result in fewer revenues to the haulers. But anytime we adjust rates in a material way like we are today or at least proposing, we have to make sure that in the end, the haulers are kept whole. So that's the whole revenue neutrality provision. So it's triggered now because we are proposing dramatic changes to the rate structure. So we had to make sure that in all this complicated formula, that in the end the revenues came out to be essentially the same, but also factor in the new cost, net new cost for the food scraps program, and the fact that we are going to, if we in fact achieve a 7% average diversion, there are going to be fewer revenues. So we had to adjust rates to provide that compensation, to compensate for the loss of revenues overall. And all of this was built into the model. But the reality is we're making a guess of what we're going to be able to achieve, and so we know we're going to be off by some amount. We're projecting 7%, but I can tell you for sure that we're not going to hit a 7% diversion. It's either going to be up above that or below that. We just don't know to what degree. We have done some sensitivity analysis, and we've determined that the range of error is somewhere in the $200,000 to $300,000 range per year. But essentially what we've developed and we've come to an agreement with the haulers on is how we true up at the end of each year, so that if we actually achieve a greater than 7% diversion, we are going to get fewer revenues than we projected. And we're going to have to make that up to the haulers. And conversely, if we do better than expected, I'm sorry, less than expected, we're going to generate more revenues. So the true-up will be is, depending on where we're at, either the haulers will be reimbursing us for the surplus, or we'll be reimbursing them for the lost revenues. And that's the whole point of revenue neutrality. We've got to keep them whole. And there is some exposure to that. And essentially, that's why we looked at what is our potential for error, and why we, remember earlier I talked about the 4.5% cushion, we wanted to generate additional revenues beyond what we, just to keep them whole, because in case we are off and we have to pay the haulers for the shorter amount of revenues, we have some funds to do so instead of tapping into our reserves. And so we targeted 4.5%, which was about $350,000. It turned out to be $340,000, which is really close to what our consultants have indicated would be the range of error. So now, with that, I'll turn it over to Stephen McIntosh. Any questions before we get into that? I know there's a lot of material, so I apologize.
We had a couple people with their lights on. Do you? Go ahead. Sure.
I know we're talking commercial. Does the school district count as commercial here? Yes. They're part of this?
Okay. Yes, they are.
Thank you.
You have something, Mr. House? Okay, never mind. Go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Madam Mayor, Council, my name again is Stephen McIntosh. I'm the Environmental Services Supervisor. And just a couple of quick slides here. We wanted to share with you what our outreach and education plan is for this new proposed rate structure, and then the timeline or the next steps for moving forward with proposed rate structure. We have contacted the Chamber, the Downtown Organization, the Hispanic Chamber, and the Restaurant and Lodging Association, the executive directors of all of those, and they've expressed an openness to coming together and have a meeting with staff, Solway staff, to discuss how we're going to present to the business community. What we'll share our presentation with these business leaders and get their feedback on what parts of the rate structure they have concerns with, just what their general concerns are with recycling in general, and including the food scrap program. But I think that'll be very, very educational for us as staff. It'll be very helpful in helping us develop our stakeholder meetings, our public forums, as well as our presentation to their groups. We're going to, and that's the second element up here. We're going to get to the downtown organization, the chamber, restaurant and lodging, and the Hispanic Chamber, and see if we can get 5 or 10 minutes on their agendas just to do a real general description of what this rate study entails, why we did it, why Council had this as part of the Solway Strategic Plan back in 2005, what the potential general policy objectives were to essentially get people to divert more material from the trash cans. So that we don't take too much of their time. Their agendas are very, very crowded or packed with items. We're going to essentially direct them to one of two public forums that are going to be taking place in April and May. Those public forums will be developed, again, in consult with the business leaders that I mentioned earlier. But we'll have a lot of information available. There will be a lot in print to hand out. There will be a lot of time for feedback or input from the business community. We want to hear what the business community's concerns are with the rate study. We're going to put together a website. Actually, we're almost done with the website if this is approved today by Council conceptually. There will be a lot of information available to businesses in the city regarding this new proposed rate structure. So, but one of the things we're going to do is provide a feedback form also on the website, so that anything that doesn't get mentioned in these public forums or isn't conveyed to staff, they can do that afterwards and easily through our website, sbrecycles.org. And then something else that was made clear to us by the Solway Committee at our meeting on February 9th was we need to make sure we get to these large customers. The 24 cubic yard example, that was the very first one in the presentation that Mr. Smario just gave. There are 25 customers in that specific class, the 24 cubic yard customers. But there's a range of customers between 20 and 30 that's larger than that. That's probably, you know, 60 or 70 customers. Anyhow, the take home or the thrust for staff on in that size class or those customers is we're going to try to get to them before July 1. We have two full-time staff dedicated to getting recycling services either instated or expanded at businesses, and we have a full-time staff person that's doing the food scrap program as well. So we're going to make as much effort as we possibly can. We'll be running reports from our new billing system, Infinity, and identifying those customers that are most likely going to face a rate increase if they don't take any action before July 1. Yeah. The next steps, again, are to implement this outreach program that I was just talking about. That'll go on for the next several months. It will actually go on for several months after that, but this is the concerted effort between March and June. The Proposition 218 noticing actually goes to the printer next week and starts getting distributed in utility bills as an insert the following week. And we have to have those completed by April 25th to meet or satisfy the 45-day public notification period of 218. Then there will be budget hearings in April and June, several of them, as you all know. And this will be part of the finance budget presentation to City Council on June 1. And the public hearing will take place on June 16th, with this rate resolution being a part of a much larger package of rates that are proposed for fiscal year 2010. And then these proposed new rates will take effect July 1 of 2009. I wanted to say one thing that I think is relatively important. Is that we've chosen 66% as somewhat aggressive. I think that's what we've heard from you and what we've heard from the Solid Waste Committee over the years. We want to be aggressive, but we want to be realistic too. 85% of the waste stream really is theoretically divertible in the business sector, but we don't want our targets or our goals to be at the top of that potential. That's just not realistic. So what we've established in our P3s, our internal measurements, is a 66% diversion rate. That's the average. If a business is doing well, they're going to save a significant amount of money by hitting that target. So with that, if there's any questions or comments, we'd be happy to.
I just wanted to remind you that we do have our two haulers here. If you have questions of them directly, they were, again, a big part of this, and I actually would encourage them to comment or provide any of their insight or feedback.
Okay, I just saw that the Integrated Waste Management Board at the state level is talking about 75% diversion as a goal. And
that's correct.
I think that's doable too, and I'm not sure exactly when they're talking about, but,
I believe it's, Madam Mayor, I believe it's Padilla, Senator Padilla or Assembly Member Padilla? Senator Member Padilla has a bill that's winding its way through a committee currently. That's a 75% goal by 2020.
Yeah.
And the Waste Board also, as you were saying, is considering a higher, more ambitious goal of 75%.
Yeah. No, very interesting, though, that we're even talking about those big numbers. That's good. Did Mr. Schmidt or Mr. Carlson have anything? I know you were very active in this, and you've taken a lot of time sitting through meetings. You might as well take a minute at the microphone or more, even. There you go. Mr. Schmidt.
Madam Mayor and City Council, I just wanted to say we've been actually talking about that food waste program since like 2004 even. In 2005, when my predecessor Darrell Reno was here, so to finally see this, come to fruition is pretty amazing, and it was a pleasure to work with the city staff on the pilot program. We've been running it for about almost 2 years now, and we were able to gather some good data, vital data, in order to, have this program implemented in July. I think going from a 40 to 50% incentive. to a 15% incentive is definitely going to change people's behavior. And I think that's kind of the point of all of this, is to change behavior. So so I wanted to thank the staff, and it's been a pleasure working with them on this project. So that's all I have to say. Any questions for me?
No, but thank you so much for your patience. It's really been good.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay.
Okay. Derek, did you have anything from Marburg?
You don't have to thank us.
Yes, Madam Mayor, members of the council, I'm glad that we have come to the conclusion of this project. There was a lot of work that was put into it. There was a very complex model that we did put all of these numbers in to come out with this, and really proud that we did use a very reliable mathematical model that we developed, so we can have faith in these numbers and use this going forward. This is not a one-year project. This is something that we're proposing, that we can use this model to make adjustments and look for our goals the next year, the next year, and the next year. And there's two ways to look at this. One way is, some trash rates are going up between 6% and 26%, but the recycle rates have dropped between 75 and 70%. Really simplistically, we're looking at the same pie. Overall, it still costs the same amount of money to go pick up a dumpster if it's, food waste in it or trash in it. There may be some small variances, but we're talking about the same pie here, and we're just looking to make adjustments in the rates that are going to be, for the biggest benefit of the city. And what we're really looking at is the diversion and how we can best get the most diversion for the city. So thank you for your time.
Thank you very much. Okay, it's to the council then. Mr. Horton, I think, was first. And then
I was working on this back when I was president of the downtown organization about 10 years ago, so I'm really happy that we're here. The only thing that I have a little bit of problem with is I talked to some of the DO board members today, just a couple hours ago, and they don't seem to be really very clued in on this that we're looking at right now. I can tell you who I talked to later. I'm wondering, these kind of things tend to get locked in once they're printed like this. And if there is significant issue with some of the members of the DO or the chamber or any other business organization, wouldn't it have been better to include them in a more inclusive basis before we get to this point where I think you're wanting us to vote today? Now, I know it says proposed. I just know that it's hard to change things once it's printed like this. So I have a process issue here that it's troubling me a little bit.
I'll start and then maybe turn it over to Stephen McIntosh, because I know he has spoken to Steve Cushman from the DO. Councilmember Horton, I'm sorry, Steve Chamber from the Chamber of Commerce, I'm sorry. It was a difficult and awkward situation. Do we talk to these businesses before we kind of come up with any proposed rates? Or we felt that it was more appropriate to first come to the Solid Waste Committee and Council with the overall rate structure they were proposing, and then take it out to the streets, if you will. And we're still going to, of course, be listening to them, and if we hear major issues or concerns, we're going to report that back to you. But we thought it, in terms of protocol, made more sense to bring it to you in terms of the details. We have mentioned to them the DO. You might recall Stephen was at a meeting, and so was I, where we talked about the goals and what we're trying to accomplish, and that we would be adjusting rates to provide greater incentives and more to encourage greater recycling. But the details, you're right, we've not gone into this kind of detail with
them. See, the problem with that is that you're talking about the bottom line on businesses. And these are tough times for businesses. And it bothers me to be getting into things that impact, the P&Ls of businesses without having them pretty fully integrated into the process. That's what's troubling to me right now. Now, if this really means proposed and we're totally open to changing it and revising it and tweaking it as we go along, then, that's fine. But otherwise, then I'm a little bit anxious about it.
Sure. Again, I will say that we are proposing this rate structure, and so with your approval, we will move forward in developing the specific rates that are consistent with this concept, with this approach. I think in terms of responding to the good point about the current environment, economic environment, is it's the right time to be raising rates. But the thing that I go back to always when we look at some of these increases that are effective July 1 is that every single business has the opportunity to save money beyond what they're paying today, which I think is really consistent with the current economic environment. So if somebody wanted to truly save money, that who has a 0% diversion by getting to 50 or even 33, they can save money beyond what they're paying today. And I think that's really the message we want to emphasize, that yeah, there's going to be dramatic increases for people who don't do anything differently, who are at zero and just choose to be at zero, but that's not where we want them, and they can all save money in the end.
Thank you. Mr. House?
I want to say, first of all, I appreciate what we're doing, why we're doing it, and how long it's taken and how complex it is, especially this whole balancing and revenue neutrality thing and all that stuff is amazing. And the spirit of it and the strategic following up on the strategy that was outlined quite some time ago, and you have been sharing that with different organizations along the way, the basic big broad brush thing. I share Mr. Horton's concerns. It seems like it's almost being framed upside down from a business model. I learned some time ago, just from my own orientation, that I had so much stuff going to the landfill from my little business that I should maybe do something else. And so I rented one of those containers, little ones, and I was overflowing that thing. So I got a half dumpster, and then pretty soon that's filled way before my other one. My other one only got full just barely, and it's kind of crazy because it's barely even got anything in it. And the other one, I'm hardly, you know, the one for recycling, I can hardly push it down. And then that was only for cardboard. And then most recently, the guys brought out the one that has all recycling can go into my dumpster, not just cardboard. So then I was able to retire this other container. I had three containers. So now I saved some money there. If I had this kind of a system here, I could have reaped some kind of financial benefit from my good intentions. And it's in a difficult time like this financially, I mean economically, it seems like what we're doing is giving businesses a chance to actually save some money in the bottom line, just like when the Edison people came out and took all my lights out and put in the ones that saved me about $100 a month. That was pretty nice. So, but it's too bad that hasn't gotten there before we're here about to make a decision on the rates. I'd like to have the businesses understand that and get that understanding in place. So what's really critical for me is that when it says right here, the council approved the proposed business trash and recycling structure, that the word proposed, even as hard as it was for you to get to this point, have a big capital P in front of it and an underline, and you know, but not quotations, that it really mean what it says. I can imagine, for instance, in downtown or anywhere around where you have limited space, you may just have room for one dumpster. So what's a person with good intentions going to do to be able to take advantage of this when they only have room for one dumpster and they can't add a second one? I bet there's a whole bunch of little things like that, that if we could get that input and feedback, we could true this up and you'd get good, positive response. So I think the reassurance I need to have today in approving this will be how bold type and capital P the proposed is in this and what we're voting on today. And I'd like to hear reassurance on that, because I think you're going to get some good feedback from people in a positive way. But we really need to get that feedback before we implement this.
Yeah. Mr. McIntosh?
Madam Mayor, Councilmember House, just on the space constraint issue, and we hear you loud and clear on the proposed issue. That's why we why that is the title of the council agenda report today. This is a proposed rate structure, and we are asking you for conceptual approval. This is not a done deal. They're approved by council and become the new rates on June 16th, I believe. So, and we will listen to the business community loud and clear on their concerns, and if there's a couple of issues here and there, we're going to communicate these issues back to you. If there's a tidal wave of concerns and opposition, we're going to communicate that back to you also. But on the space constraints issue in particular, we have our dedicated recycling coordinators out there in the field every day, and they've gotten extremely creative and have been very successful with space constrained customers. As you know, and you'll know even more so now that you're downtown, the space-constrained customers are are typically along the State Street corridor in the downtown core, and there are a lot of them. But some of the solutions to that issue have been very successful, again, with our recycling coordinators. One of them is bin sharing. Two neighbors in a lot of situations, two or multiple neighbors now are sharing one trash dumpster and one recycling dumpster in separate enclosures. That's been very, very successful. And with our new billing system, we with the old billing system, we were limited to 25, 33, and 50% splits for bills, and they all had to go to one person, or they had to divvy them up by the end of, at the end of the month and all this. But now there's an infinite number of potential splits for a bill with our new billing system, so customers can actually be billed directly for the appropriate amount of trash service that they're receiving in a dumpster that they're sharing with seven other people or seven other businesses. So bin sharing really is a key to dealing with the space constraint issue, and we realize that it's real. A lot of businesses now will be breaking into smaller containers. Now that we're offering food as well, they can have recycling, they can have green waste, and they can have food. A lot of those waste streams being broken down into three or four categories can actually result in a customer going from 2 yards or a 3 yard dumpster into several smaller containers, and those will fit in a small enclosure. So that's one potential bonus as well. We're looking at split dumpsters. Some jurisdictions are actually pursuing split dumpsters where there's a 3 yarder that has half of it locking. It's cut, it's got a divider in the middle, so the truck comes and empties half of it on Thursday, and on Saturday they lock the other side and empty the other half. Victoria Core is a great example of a space-constrained customer. About a year and a half ago, they got serious about diversion. They have space there that's actually an indoor enclosure that has space for 3 4-yard dumpsters collected 6 days a week. They cannot get more service than that. Three trash dumpsters going 6 days a week. They said, okay, we're going to do this. We're going to recycle as much as possible. They, with city staff, actually switched out two of those 4 yarders of trash and put in recycling. 6 days a week recycling. That took a little bit of groundwork or footwork on the front end, getting the containers in all the offices and making sure the staff were trained, but they're doing it. They're diverting 66% of their waste stream now. They didn't have to go outside the enclosure. They didn't really have to do anything else with the space. They had to get serious about it, and they did. They're succeeding with a very space-constrained situation. And then one last thing that's longer term, but it's actually having quite an impact, is we see all of this discretionary permits that come through the Community Development Department. They're routed as part of the DART Development Application Review Team, I think is what that stands for. But they're routed as part of that process through my staff, and they actually check the plans and make sure that there is space for that development to have recycling and trash and food or green waste. So we're taking care of it in a lot of ways, on a lot of fronts. We are coming up with additional tools as well for the space issue.
Well, you know, what you just gave me and gave all of us here and whomever's watching is just really remarkably good. I mean, you're showing people how they can save money in dealing with their trash. I mean, businesses need to see that. And they need to see that you're there with really good creative strategies to make sure that it can work, and the haulers are already prepared to do it in such a way that they benefit from it. Now, that's an incredibly important way to frame this, and it's genuine. It's authentic. So when you're putting together these workshops or these seminars or whatever you propose to do, it seems to me that that's got to be the spirit and the presentation and the marketing and the whole thing. So you don't get an unnecessary backlash, which I could imagine could happen if it were otherwise just we're going to raise the rates. So I really appreciate you're taking the time to share that with us, and we need to get that word out to the business community.
Thank you.
Just to follow up,
sure,
again, we're not approving any rates today. We're not asking, because that's going to happen in June when we approve all the rate resolutions, including these. So we're going to go through that education outreach effort, and we're going to, again, since Stephen indicated, report back to what we hear. But I think when we talk to the folks, just as Stephen and to discuss with you how some of these solutions can be addressed or issues can be addressed, I think we're going to get pretty good support and response. I really do. There are always going to be some issues and concerns on certain businesses, but I think by and large we'll be able to address some of the, a lot of their concerns or most of the concerns, and be able to save the money. But again, we're not doing anything final today. It's June, and we have 3-4 months to kind of talk to them and find out what some of those concerns might be and which ones we haven't been able to address.
Okay. Thank you, Ms. Falcone. And then Ms.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Well, first of all, let me thank Marburg. And what are you called now?
Allied Republic.
I know, Tor. Hmm? It is Allied. Yeah, okay. I thought it was something else. Okay. But I know that the two of you, Tor Schmidt and Derek Carlson, have put in, as was said before, untold hours on this, and we're very grateful to you, because without your expertise on the ground, this is how it really works. I mean, we can fuddle around in the dark here for forever and come up with something that's completely impractical. So with your help, hopefully we're starting off with a practical application here. You know, once upon a time we had an idea about mandatory commercial recycling, and that program has been put indefinitely on the back burner. I don't quite know whatever happened to it. I'd like to see it resurrected. Maybe this is a precursor to that, because if we get people voluntarily recycling, although when you sort of twist their arms through the rates, I'm not quite sure how voluntary that really is. But it's not a mandatory program. So maybe we'll see how this goes for a while, see if it achieves the desired goals, and then we can pick up on the mandatory recycling program a little further down the road. But this, I share the concerns that I've heard here today, although this is the third, maybe fourth time I've seen this presentation. Education campaign, the outreach to the businesses, especially, as you said, the businesses that are going to get whacked with these rates. You're going to have to justify where you came up with the numbers. I'm not sure I'm really satisfied with that explanation yet. It still feels a little bit like plucking things out of the air, and I'm concerned about that. I do understand that the model was developed by a professional in the field, and that everybody who knows anything about it has tremendous reliance on the model, that it's doing the job that we are hoping that it does, which is coming up with a viable and reasonable structure. However, I don't think I'm sanguine yet. You haven't convinced me that it isn't just plucking numbers out of the air. So I need a little bit more on that. And you're certainly going to have to talk to the businesses about it. I don't know about seminars and group workshops and so forth. I think that especially the ones that are going to feel the largest impacts, or maybe even any impact, are going to have to be touched personally. I know that takes longer. I know that is much more labor intensive. I don't care. No, I do care. I care deeply. But I really think it's necessary. I truly, truly do, that you go to people and really personally, with the laundry list of what you can do to affect change in your store personally, individually, is what's going to be required here. Because our phones will start to ring like you have no idea, especially since it's already kind of getting out there, as Roger said, and people are like, what is this? You know, I don't know anything about this, and it's going to affect my bottom line. So there's a lot of work to be done. I would like to, in the recommendation, add the word that council conceptually approve the proposed in red ink business trash and recycling structure. So when that comes around, Madam Mayor, if you want me to make that motion, I can do that now. But I'd like to see the word conceptually approve all of this, and then you can go forward and do it. Shouldn't make any difference to you at all, except that it calls it out more clearly.
Okay, is there a second?
Sure, second.
Okay. Oh, thank you, Mr. Williams.
I seconded the motion, but I think we're drifting away from a little bit, drifting into the realm of people's fears, as opposed to the reality of this is not a rate increase. This is a rate structure change, which will mean an increase for some and a decrease for just as many, because we're not allowed to make more money off of this, right? We're keeping this revenue neutral. So I think that's one of the messages we really need to let people know loud and clear. I think that it's important that I agree with the sentiment that there are some folks that we need to touch that aren't just the biggest users, but maybe the ones whose percentage change in rates could be the greatest. Okay, so I think we need to target some smaller users whose change will be a greater percentage, as well as the big ones. But this inherently is fixing a problem. Let's not forget that. The problem is that the rates right now do not incentivize recycling. That's the basic problem. We're relying off of people being like, you know, touchy-feely and green to go out and recycle, when we should be relying off of people's self-interest to go out and recycle. And that's what this rate structure will do. It will give people a profit motive to recycle more. They'll save money off of what they are currently paying. And if, you know, they just don't care, or if they're, you know, got other priorities that are bigger, then they might pay a little bit more in rates. What we don't want to do is have people who really want to recycle more but are somehow constrained to be punished by the rate system. And I think that's why we need to take some public input. And my preference in that part, because of how much it could have, if there is a case like that, I do not think that we should be changing the overall rate structure, because what's important about the model is if you reduce the rates for someone, then you're also going to reduce the amount of savings that someone else is going to get for recycling. So if there is a specific case of one segment that is not, you know, needs some help to be able to do that, then I think we should probably take that out of our sensitivity, our cushion with the haulers, and not out of other rates, because we could totally upset this rate structure's ability to increase recycling with just a few of those exceptions. So I really want to praise staff for bringing this forward, and say it's been really great to serve with my committee members on the Solid Waste Committee and looking at these issues, because, you know, we can do all the idealistic things that we can ever think of, but at the end of the day, people are going to recycle more if they save money because they're recycling, and that's what this rate structure accomplishes.
Absolutely. Ms. Schneider. And then.
Thank you. I just also want to extend my thanks to the subcommittee members and staff and the haulers, because to get to this point, and I think just to underscore, we're trying to create a structure that will modify behavior to the way where we want, and to the point where we don't need a new landfill. And can you imagine what the rates would look like if we had to find a new landfill? And this is all getting towards that ultimate goal of diverting as much as possible away from the landfill. And I want to echo Council Members House and Horton about the customer service side in the next couple of months, about what this is going to mean to particular organizations and businesses. And that the work you do in the next couple of months, I think, will make all the difference when this comes back to us in answering those questions and dealing with the fear factor. And another benefit to this is, we just had a joint meeting with the Santa Barbara School District and heard about their budgetary woes. And here's one way we can actually assist them in reducing their overall cost by tens of thousands of dollars district-wide, because these rates will affect them as well. And I can attest from serving on that committee with the school district recycling committee that our city staff, our environmental services staff, literally go into the dumpsters and figuring out how they can best reduce their services while diverting as much as possible. And so the added benefit of helping out our local businesses as well as our school district in these tight economic times, I think, is really the right thing to do on a whole lot of levels. And so I'm excited to see this forward. But I would agree with my colleagues that what you do between now and June is really going to put the test to, you know, put this to the test in terms of getting that educational materials out. So I look forward to hearing the results of that come June, and I'll be supporting the motion.
Okay. We have a motion and a second.
One more comment.
Okay, go ahead.
I just want to caution DOS that this, I think, as far as I know, only two of us here that are currently small business owners. And I can tell you that if I got a notice in the mail that I'm from the government and I'm going to be helping your business, I can tell you what I'd think. So it may seem irrational to some, but believe me, it's a real thought. The other thing is, I don't want to consider this rate as a part of a package from finance of 477 rates. I don't know what your plans are on that, but that's not my vision. Because I know that we get to look at the rate increases as a part of the city budget process. But I don't think this is too different for me to include it with 25 cents more in tennis or something like that. That's what the point I'm trying to make.
If I could, Madam Mayor,
Councilmember
Gordon, essentially what happens in June, it's really more of a formality where the council adopts all the rate resolutions all together, but we do go through them individually. When departments present their respective budgets, they go through their rates and their fees and their proposed changes. And so likewise, as part of finance's presentation, we'll be covering this as well. And we might, if we need to, actually present to council separately just a discussion of these rates and the responses from the community and the business sector in terms of based on our outreach and education. So that would be part of it. So it's not going to be lumped into a bunch of other rate resolutions.
Okay. Thank you very much. We have a motion and a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you all.
We're going to take
that's why they say I'm from the city and here to help, not from the government.
That's right. We don't say we're from government. Okay. We'll take a real quick break while you get...
I'll have to change my plan. I should have realized there'd be another man.
Okay, we're going to call the Santa Barbara City Council meeting back to order. And we are on to item number,
Eight.
Eight, thank you.
Capital Improvement Projects, second quarter report for fiscal year 2009.
Okay, Mr. Kelly.
Thank you. Pat Kelly, Assistant Public Works Director, City Engineer. Good afternoon. This is a report that will give you a snapshot of the city's capital improvement projects. I'll go over the design, completed projects, and some construction in progress, and plus I'll have a video at the end of the presentation.
Good.
This quarter, for this second quarter of the fiscal year, one project was completed at a value of approximately $2 million. It's the Santa Barbara Airport South Apron Rehabilitation. I just want you to know it'll be a flurry of projects in the second half of the fiscal year and have a lot more work to talk about. This project, the Airport South Apron, mostly replaced World War II era pavements. Yes, there's still pavements that old out there. This photo shows reconstructed concrete pavements. However, the majority of the work was replacing asphalt in the vicinity of the new terminal and just south of that. Here is a photo showing that the finished construction of a lateral special linear drain, that much of the area is very flat, and so we have to have special drainage facilities to collect the water. 10 capital projects were in construction in that second quarter of the fiscal year,
Madam
with a value of over $22 million.
Okay, Mr. Horton, go ahead.
Just want to ask a quick question.
Quick push on that one.
When you do this kind of thing, are you anticipating the same aircraft, or are you anticipating an aircraft that might be heavier?
The design of these pavements are aprons are usually like 14 inches of concrete, so they're designed for the modern airlines or modern airplanes. I'd rely on the airport department to give us that kind of data. So we have 10 projects that were in construction I'd like to talk about in the second quarter, and have a feature of about three of these. This is the another project, the airport terminal apron and taxiway B realignment. And this is a 14-inch thick concrete slab and 20 by 20 slabs or you see the concrete dowels that are used to create control joints for those individual slabs and tie them together. The Federal Aviation Administration has provided grant funds for this project up to 95%, with the city providing the other 5%. And this is the picture of the mission at 101 Bike Lanes. It's substantially complete. We just still have some streetlights to provide. And this project was designed to improve bicycle safety, wheelchair access, and pedestrian activity along under 101. And hopefully the landscaping, when it fills in, will improve the aesthetics. The bikeway, the project completes the Pacific Coast bike route through Santa Barbara by adding bike lanes between Castillo and Modoc. The project was funded by federal grants, Caltrans, and city funds. In fact, the Caltrans funds, they were obliged to provide access ramps at this intersection. This has been a high priority for our wheelchair access community for many years, and so we were able to use those funds with an economy of scale to do the rest of the work. Also, another project, Public Works, bread and butter, is the sewer main rehabilitation. This was funded by our wastewater capital bonds. The pipe rehabilitation is a cost-effective and energy-saving maintenance process. The rehabilitation does not require excavation, and we simply lined the existing sewer and thereby saving materials and construction equipment and fuel. Here's another photo. We just set up over the manhole and go from manhole to manhole. And this work does prevent infiltration during rains also. We are testing that right now during this last rainstorm. And we're still sorting through the data, but preliminary results show that this has been an effective program. Also, we have 47 projects in design managed by Public Works Engineering, and this table is shown in the staff report, working on a wide variety of projects throughout the entire city. This $216,000 includes the airport terminal projects, which are
million.
Thank you. That is scheduled for council consideration for award at the next week. Here's a project that I'm very familiar with, and this is the city's Lower Mission Creek flood control project. The city was successful in getting a $1 million Prop 50 grant last year, and with that comes a $1.5 million match from the county flood control district using their South Coast assessments, South Coast zone assessments. The construction is proposed to go between State Street and Mason. Unfortunately, it's still dependent upon state funding, but we anticipate that that will be cleared. And with completion by funding of design money acquired by Congresswoman Capps, we hope to start construction next summer. Now, a separate project other than the grant was the recent construction of the Lower Mission Creek culvert under the railroad tracks. This was, for myself and many others, a very interesting project. And in fact, at the end of this presentation will be a video from our city TV that will also be a preview on Inside Santa Barbara. So here is a photo of the reinforced concrete box units that were installed. Then we have some progress photos of, first of all, after the tracks were cleared of Amtrak and other train traffic, the work for the culvert was completed within 60 hours to before train traffic was restored. Started on a Sunday morning. By the way, I had donuts and coffee for all those who were interested. At 7 a.m., only had one taker. The tracks were cut and moved away, and the digging of the culvert started immediately. Here's another progress photo of the work. Then here is after the culvert construction was complete, rail traffic was available within 60 hours. And it took several more days before the total site was restored. Here you can see the deck was completed and still have to put the barriers in and some more work behind it. And the culvert goes underneath here, and in the future it will be extended through the parking lot and then up to the freeway. And eventually the culvert will be extended in both directions to the existing channel, where the channel will be widened, and with some widened, with that will significantly reduce the probability of flooding in this part of town. Also, a little pre-advertisement. Please check www.lowermissioncreek.com for more information about the project.
Oh. Yeah, Mr. House has a question for you.
Yes, Mr. Kelly, my understanding is that that part that we just saw going in there and that you were just talking about, extension across, that's for the high flow part of, like, if there were a storm, that it would not just meander through the standard channel, but the water would rise up to the level to go through this shortcut across. Am I correct in that understanding?
Absolutely. And the historic channel will be preserved, and the historic channel will be actually the fish passage.
Because if this were just where the fish would go, they couldn't make it through that. So this is going to, we're still going to have the historic channel.
Correct.
The fish will still have a chance to get on up the creek, right, and it'll still meander and do its thing. But if there's a big flow, a big rush of water down, it has a safe way to get across there without causing damage.
Correct.
Phenomenal.
This is another project that will be starting construction this summer. And this has been in the plans for some time. You can see a beaten path along here. This is Loma Alta between the top of the hill on the mesa near McKinley School going down into the lower west side community. And here's one of the old streetlight foundations that used to be there. And in fact, this project will restore the street lighting and also, which will also be pedestrian lighting. The grant was approved back in 2002, however, construction funding was not set aside or delayed until this fiscal year. And this is, for the most part, 100% grant funding, with the city making up some other funds to do some special embellishments. In fact, the street lighting is going to be, the fixtures themselves will be funded by CDBG, Community Development Block Grant Funds, to make everything work. And we hope that with good bids, we'll even be able to conserve some cash for other streets projects. Here's another showing the beaten path. Also, as part of the project, we'll be constructing access ramps. This one is at the corner of Canna Perdido and Maria. And in a future project, we'll be extending curb and gutter and also sidewalk through the rest of the neighborhood, so to make a complete neighborhood connection. Here is the a deteriorated manhole, and the wastewater main replacement for this coming year will be a replacement of several main throughout the city. And also a key element, which is shown here, is upgrading some of the manholes near the El Estero treatment plant. Another very important project, a large project in the scale of total project cost of about $20 million, will be the Cater Water Treatment Plant Ozone, a CO2 project, which will improve the city's water quality. The funding is anticipated to be funded by the State Drinking Water State Revolving Fund. And we'll be working on the details of that. The funding, the revolving fund, is a combination of Proposition 13 from 2000, Proposition 50 in 2002, and 84 in 2006. Also, a project that is about to go out to bid is the West Cabrillo Pedestrian Improvements, funded by the Redevelopment Agency, which will improve the pedestrian linkage between Stearns Wharf and the harbor. Another project, a little bit more detail on this one, is the West Downtown Pedestrian Improvements. And this is to create a pedestrian corridor between the pedestrian bridges over 101, both on Anapamu and on Ortega, all the way to Chapala. And Work is scheduled this summer. Some of the key features include the development of additional street lighting, new pedestrian lighting, a sidewalk repair, and brick sidewalks at intersections, some intersection bulb outs, and additional street trees. And here I'd like to show you a progression of three pictures and focus on here are the street trees. This is the presentation we made to ABR and to our Parks and Recreation Commission that shows how these trees will grow and develop into part of the neighborhood. So this is using our Photoshop program. We have a two-year-old photo that the city arborist, a photo of a two-year-old red flowering gum that the city arborist took. Here it is, a picture that we photoshopped in from another five-year-old tree. And here's what the tree will look like in the neighborhood in 10 years from now. So not a part of the key parts of the project is the aesthetics of the neighborhood with a total of up to 69 trees we're adding to the neighborhood, along with approximately 8 pedestrian streets per block, as well as improved intersection lighting. And before I move on to the video, I'd be very happy to answer any questions.
Okay, are there any questions? I don't think so. I think we're ready for a video.
Okay.
A game show?
Again, another, not a game show this time. but another excellent job by our city TV. Mm-hmm. Okay. There it is. It's warming up.
The Lower Mission Creek project area is 1.3 miles of creek between Cabrillo Boulevard and Canyon Perdido, impacted by urban development. Most of the year, the Lower Creek trickles runoff from 7,200 acres of watershed above it. But when it rains heavily, that trickle turns to torrent, and historically, that has meant trouble for the surrounding businesses and homes. The area is prone to flooding. In 1995, El Nino storms caused millions in flood damage. Floods also drenched lower parts of the city in 1998 and 2005. To prevent catastrophic damage, the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, the Santa Barbara County Flood Control District, and the City of Santa Barbara joined forces in the Lower Mission Creek Flood Control Project.
The overall Mission Creek Project has a capacity improvement from, I believe, 1,500 cubic feet per second to 3,400 cubic feet per second. The bottleneck in the system is right here on Montecito Street. It's the Montecito Street Bridge. It has a 1,500 cubic feet per second capacity. So what the culvert's going to do is approximately carry the remaining capacity, which is about 1,900 cubic feet per second.
To achieve this, the project will combine a series of bridge replacements and channel improvements.
One other aspect, in addition to the flood control aspect, is that over the years we've tried to incorporate more and more creek restoration and water quality improvement aspects. And so as part of the project design, we have incorporated habitat improvements for wildlife, including some endangered species like the Southern California steelhead. We've also added elements of landscaping with native trees to provide shade and cooling and other native plants.
Due to the time, cost, and complexity of the project, a multi-phase approach was implemented. The project broke ground with the installation of these culverts under the Union Pacific Railroad, a critical first step that involved closing the tracks.
And the railroad is a very technical operation. They don't like to shut their rails down for long periods of time. It costs a lot of money when the rail service is out. It has to involve coordination with Amtrak because we got an extensive passenger train service that goes through Santa Barbara. So all of this has to be done, and there are only certain windows that happen. So in this particular case, the UP Railroad, who was really a tremendous partner with us, identified a window that they could close the rails down.
And we were allowed a 60-hour window where they would actually do the work continuously, nonstop.
After the last train rolled through, the clock started ticking. In 60 hours, crews had to first physically cut 200 feet of the tracks and move them out of the way, then excavate 13 feet below grade before they could install 30 massive 47-ton concrete box culverts underground, totaling over 1,200 tons and measuring about 85 feet long.
Well, the funding for the culvert project is from local fundings, the flood control, local revenues, taxes, and benefit assessments. And that is money that's collected locally and funded 100% of this project. The balance of the project is expected to be funded with a combination of city, federal, and maybe even state fundings along with local money. But this particular was 100% county flood control funded. Net result is the Mission Creek project's now under construction. Perhaps the most critical element of the whole project is now built, and so now that will help us petition the federal government for additional money to continue the construction.
You know, in the grand perspective of things, the amount of flood protection that this will give the city is a cost savings to the citizens of the city. If a flood happens, the amount of damage it can occur can be tens of millions of dollars. And when you look at the project's cost overall, from Cannon Perdido all the way down to the beach, is, you know, somewhere in the range of $50 to $60 million, and over time it will pay for itself.
For more information and updates on this project, visit www.lowermissioncreek.org.
Thank you. And as noted, we're using that website, lowermissioncreek.org, as our application venue to work for additional federal and other grants to keep this project moving along.
That's good.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. That was wonderful.
Mr. Kelly, on that kind of a project, the percentage of our contribution is approximately how much? Our local contribution?
Well, it depends on each individual item. For example, on the culvert, the flood control district paid 100% of that. For the Prop 50 grant, the city is funding the environmental and the application process, but the grant is a construction grant being paid for with the flood control match. Our grant project, our bridge projects, which are essential elements of the completion of the project, is 88% grant funded and 12% city. So there's just so many different projects. Some are 100% where we have an investment of staff time, which is a cost.
Right.
And then others, there is some capital investment.
So when you say like 88% or 100%, that's federal or state money that is money that was tax money. It came from somewhere. It came from taxpayers somewhere. And then we wouldn't necessarily get that here in Santa Barbara unless we did this, the engineering work or the work that you've done to apply for it and to administer our end of the bargain.
Exactly.
And our portion, which is a relatively small part, is what allows us to attract that kind of funding to do the things that we need to do.
Yes, there's, like for example, on that culvert project, there was a year or so of planning to get the coastal development permit for that work, and it also required the relocation of a 12-inch interstate fiber optic network that has federal information in it, and that was a significant effort to get that relocated. So there's there's a lot that isn't seen in order to make these things happen.
It's just what's amazing to me, and I hope you don't mind my just saying this. When we're talking about, like, we invest money on our in our portfolio and as a city, and we may see 4% and 4.5%, 3%, 5% return on our investments. And here we invest 11% of a project, and we get back tens and of millions of dollars back as return on our investment of our staff time and energy. It just boggles the mind. But without that, I can't imagine what we would do. We'd just be we'd be missing all these opportunities. So thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. And we're going to go ahead and read item 9, please.
Item number 9, conference with legal counsel pending litigation.
Okay, we will adjourn out of that, out of the close.